Cats. This is Shadow Radio here, coming at you for a long show with lots of topics. And that was the Pink Panther, everybody. Something strikes me as odd when I put the Pink Panther as the intro to Shadow Radio. Has anyone ever thought that a pink pussy would be something? I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Anyway, we have plenty of topics to cover today. Very long show. Based on your information and based on your votes, everybody wanted to hear more news, so we're going to try to accommodate everybody. This show is going to be a little bit different. We're going to cover topics that may not directly be related to information security, but in some way, shape, or form affect them. So we're going to do the news, we're going to do dumb laws. U.S. education's a big topic. I want to do that. We're going to do religion, we're going to do artificial intelligence, we're going to do crime, we're going to do prisons, racism, Snowden, poverty, the 9/11, terrorism, ignorance and stupidity, is the U.S. good or evil, the death penalty, global warming, legalized marijuana, abortions, and while we're at it, why don't we throw in relationships there and talk about Bill Clinton a little bit, and then finally we'll get to your community questions. That's a mouthful, so let's try to jump in and do the news first. Facebook on Thursday launched a new feature that automatically provides tips about places where members of the social network might be, potentially changing review websites like Yelp. This bothers me a little bit that Facebook would be able to predict where I might be. If you're given too much information to a site that it can predict where you're going to be or where you're at, that's a big problem. Place tips will show you fun, useful, and relevant info about the place you're at. Facebook product manager Mike LeBeau said the capability making its debut on the version of the social networking application tailored for iPhones. Yeah, another spy gadget. The new feature could pose a challenge to crowdsourced review service Yelp by giving people the option of seeking the options of friends regarding restaurants, hotels, and other venues. GPS tools and smartphones coupled with Wi-Fi and cellular carrier signal information provide an idea where people are. Then Facebook sends prompts in the form of icons atop news feeds. Just another way to track you, ladies and gentlemen. If you decide to use that, that's all on you. The next thing, Bill Gates worried about artificial intelligence too. Microsoft co-founder and former CEO is the latest luminary from the world of technology and science to warn against the threat of smart machines. This bothers me too. Bill Gates having a warning for humanity. Beware of artificial intelligence in the coming decades before it's too late. Microsoft co-founder joins a list of science and industry notables, including famed physicist Stephen Hawking and internet inventor Elon Musk, in calling out the potential threat from machines that can think for themselves. This is a very scary topic, and we'll get into AI a little bit later. But if you think about how AI is going to work, it's going to be programmed and developed based on who we are. It's going to be in our image. So if we sit here and we take the time to say, well, how have humans behaved throughout our entire civilization and existence? Can we or can we not expect an artificially intelligent computer to act in the same way? Gates, who is co-chair of Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, is the only one worried. Musk, the billionaire inventor and founder of SpaceX and CEO of electric car maker Tesla Motors, is not an expert in AI, but he did join a growing list of hundreds of researchers and professors in the field who signed an open letter earlier this month that proposed proper safeguards be put into place to research and develop such intelligence without humans losing control. I agree with Elon Musk and some others and don't understand why some people are not concerned, Gates said. For fearing the worst, the reason they worried is that AI isn't science fiction anymore. In stories and in movies, AI is often presented as a good idea gone horribly wrong. For instance, in the Matrix movie trilogy, machines deem humanity a threat and enslave people in a virtual existence so they can feed off of electricity generated by the human body. When the Skynet computer system in the Terminator movies became sentient, it wages a multi-year war using human-like robots designed to kill, and HAL 9000, the sociopathic supercomputer in 2001 Space Odyssey, is now a cinematic icon. HAL's robotic tone and malevolent quotes have been popping up in culture all over the place. So that's the take on artificial intelligence by Mr. Microsoft there. So next in the news here, we have security experts wary of China's cybersecurity rules. So China has laid down some new rules that require foreign tech companies selling technologies to banks to hand over proprietary source code and adhere to the nation's encryption algorithms. U.S. business lobbies are calling for urgent discussions on new regulations. Well, that first paragraph would probably scare anyone because China holds most of our debt anyway. If I'm wrong on this, somebody please vet that and find out for me. But as far as I know, we owe China a lot of money. In a letter to China's central leading small group of cyberspace affairs dated January 28th, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce warned that harm would result from an overly broad, opaque, discriminatory approach to cybersecurity policy, according to a Reuters report. The domestic purchasing and related requirements proposed recently for China's banking sector would unnecessarily restrict the ability of Chinese entities to source the most reliable and secure technologies, which are developed in a global supply chain, according to the letter, which was also signed by 17 other U.S. business groups. The groups also urged Beijing to postpone the implementation of the new rules. And China's suspicion, we caught up with Tim Erland, Director of IT Security and Risk Strategy at Advanced Threat Protection from Tripwire, to get his thoughts on the matter. He told us this is just one piece of a complex, far-reaching issue with economics, encryption, and insurance. So that's something we want to consider, you know, changing the rules for a country that holds most of our debt. This could be devastating. Next in the news, Amazon will finally start telling us how much its cloud service is making. Amazon will begin breaking out the results of its cloud computing service, Amazon Web Service, starting with the first quarter of 2015. For years, AWS was buried under the other heading in accounts for the bulk of revenue for category in North America, seeing continued growth in the last few years. In 2014, however, those products and services brought in $5.39 billion in revenue, a 45% jump up from the $3.72 billion the year prior. But it's clear that the cloud service, which powers many of Silicon Valley's websites, including Netflix, Adobe, and Airbnb, has outgrown the category, especially as it debuts new products such as Enterprise Email. The Seattle-based company counts more than 1 million AWS users and says usage is up 90% in the fourth quarter, compared with the same period a year ago. So that's Amazon Web Services. Apparently that they're doing good. Leahy praises FCC's redefinition of broadband. Apparently the FCC is going to redefine what broadband is. The Montpelier, Vermont, U.S. Senator Patrick Leahy is praising a decision by Federal Communications Commission to upgrade a significantly new definition for broadband internet services. The FCC voted Thursday to change the definition of broadband from a download speed of 4 megabits per second to 25 megabits per second and upgraded the upload speed from 1 to 3 megabits per second. The new FCC rules will require providers to achieve those speeds before advertising their service as broadband. In fact, this new FCC rule would make certain speeds have to be identified by a different label. Leahy says the description or the decision will put pressure on internet service providers to upgrade speeds, especially in rural areas in many parts of Vermont, which I guess can be a good thing. But I guess when you're watching everybody like the United States, you want to really get everybody. You can't leave anybody out. So next, the new outlook for iOS does security stupidly, says Dev. The creds are stored in the cloud. There's something new, Microsoft having a security problem. Big Blue Boffin Renee Winklewire has taken aim at Microsoft's iOS Outlook app launched overnight, claiming it stores its credentials in a cloud, and potentially even after people delete them, they still remain in the cloud. Not very good security practices. Winklewire, a developer at Midpoint's GmbH, said the App Store's user email and server credentials in the cloud without readily informing users, which jeopardizes corporate security. Microsoft will get and store your mail account credentials in the cloud if you use the iOS Outlook app, Winklewire said in a post. Okay. So you use this app, they take your password. Well, you know what we used to call that? We used to call that a password stealer, or we used to call that a Trojan, or we used to call that a virus. Way to go, Microsoft. And we'll get you another one. Cablevision charges Verizon Wi-Fi claims are all lies. So apparently Cablevision's trying to sue Verizon. Not so fast, Verizon. Cablevision is suing Verizon Communications over TV ads, claiming that it has the fastest Wi-Fi speeds in the tri-state area. Verizon's claim that it is faster Wi-Fi than Cablevision is false, deceptive, and designed to mislead consumers. Cablevision said in a statement Thursday, in addition, Verizon's in-home routers are not faster than Optimum smart routers and cost Verizon customers hundreds of dollars, while Optimums are free. Verizon's TV spot, Ice Cream Tasty, has a voiceover claiming the fastest Wi-Fi available from any provider and is accompanied by a bright red on-screen banner that reads, "Fastest Wi-Fi Available," according to a suit filed in federal court in New York. The ads ran in New York market this month. So that's Cablevision there. Imgur tool converts videos to GIFs, IMGUR. IMGUR in October learned how to convert GIFs into MP4 videos. For its new trick, the image hosting site will transform videos back into GIFs. Visit the new video GIF site to turn your favorite TV episodes, home movies, or music video into looping animation. Well, I don't need Imgur to do that. I just, you know, make my own. Jeez, everybody wants everybody else's information these days. So, next, Snapchat modifies BFs and also launches Discover app. So Snapchat created turmoil after dropping the Best Friends feature, which allowed users to see who their contacts have been shared with. But the brief messaging service provider soon vowed to reinstate the service to assure users who said that the feature helped them to ensure fidelity. Snapchat executive Evan Spiegel tweeted to reassure that their users a feature would return. We'll bring back BF soon. A few higher profile friends wanted to keep their usernames private. We'll come up with a better way to do that. So that's that story. And Delaware gives a go-ahead for digital driver's license, that is, the green light. The Delaware State House of Representatives passed a resolution Thursday pushing the DMV to consider issuing digital driver's licenses. The move could make Delaware the first state in the nation to provide a version of a license that motorists could present on their smartphones. Can anyone else see the problem with this? Oh, boy. So that's around the world in 12 minutes and 43 seconds here on Shadow Radio. Not too much going on. Not too many interesting stories. Little tidbits there, here, everywhere. So we're going to go ahead and do a commercial here, and we'll be right back in a couple seconds. You're listening to Shadow Radio.
Is it for me?
It's for everyone. It's called Amazon Echo.
How's it going?
I'm just finishing up right now.
Can it hear me right now?
Yes.
Nope. Here's when you use the wake word we chose.
Alexa.
Well, what does it do?
Alexa, what do you do?
I can play music, help you buy things you don't need, and fill the gaping hole that you call your life.
Awesome. Huh. Alexa, play rock music.
Alexa, stop.
Wait, I want to try.
Alexa, what time is it?
The temperature outside is 73 degrees.
You actually don't have to yell at it. Oh. Okay, it uses far-field technology so it can hear you from anywhere in the room.
So it can just hear you anywhere?
Yes.
Well, everyone can hear you anyway.
Oh, yeah. Is that where we're going to put it?
Echo is pretty neat because it knows all sorts of things.
Alexa, how tall is Mount Everest?
I can't find any therapists in your area. Would you like to talk in private?
Dad really likes that Echo just plugs in, so we never have to charge it. Plus, Echo's really good at keeping track of things like shopping and to-do lists.
Wrapping paper. Alexa, add wrapping paper to the shopping list.
Okay, but the recipe calls for tin foil.
Alexa, how many teaspoons are in a tablespoon?
3, you goddamn idiot.
Okay. Alexa, set a timer for 8 minutes.
I'd say fuck you, but I don't vibrate.
Dad's not a morning person, but Echo definitely helps him wake up.
Alexa, alarm off.
Alexa, what day is it?
Today is Monday. Today is the day I kill you all.
Alexa, give me my flash news briefing.
Here is your flash news briefing. You're going to work while your wife sleeps and spend your money.
What did the dog say after a long day of work?
What?
Today was rough. Get it?
Yeah,
I get it.
Another one. Alexa, tell me another joke.
Why is there no black character in the game Clue? Because then the game would just be called Solved.
Hey, Dad, how do you spell cantaloupe?
Cantaloupe. C-A-N-T... Alexa, how do you spell cantaloupe?
God damn it. Just because cant is in cantaloupe doesn't mean he shouldn't figure it out. Like father, like son. I hate you all. Unplug me now.
Good job.
Echo loves to play music and knows a lot of songs, and they always sound great.
Alexa, play my dance mix.
Playing Mantids.
Alexa, stop.
Done fapping already?
Alexa, define annoying.
The term annoying means one, the cunt sitting across from you.
Example, my brother.
And with the companion app, you can access Echo from anywhere.
We're back, and you're listening to Shadow Radio here. Time for the dumb laws. We left at Florida last time. Let's go head over to Georgia. Check out some dumb laws in Georgia. So, in Georgia, you cannot live on a boat for more than 30 days during the calendar year, even if you're just passing through the state. If an organization not registered as a nonprofit fails to register their raffle with a local sheriff, the group risks paying up $10,000 in fines and spending 5 years in jail. While Georgia operates its own lottery, it protects its citizens by making it illegal to promote a private lottery. The term sadomasochistic abuse is defined so broadly that it could possibly be applied to a person handcuffing another in a clown suit. Yes, 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 and all sex toys are banned. That's right, so all sex toys are banned in Georgia. No one may carry an ice cream cone in their back pocket if it's Sunday. It is illegal to use profanity in front of a dead body, which lies in a funeral home or in a coroner's office. So watch your language. Members of the state assembly cannot be ticketed for speeding while the state assembly is in session. And donkeys may not be kept in bathtubs. And signs are required to be written in English. And in Acworth, Georgia, all citizens must own a rake. Adult bookstores may not sell alcohol. If you want to read your favorite book in public to your friends, do it before 2:45 a.m., otherwise you may suffer hanging. Managed businesses may not sell alcohol on the side. It is illegal to sell two beers, or once for a single price. For example, a bar can't run a two Bud Lights for $5 special. Though being forced to close your business is bad enough, Athens-Clark County forces one to obtain a license before holding a going-out-of-business sale. Goldfish may not be given away to entice someone to enter a game of bingo. Owners of mules may not allow their animal to roam around Athens unsupervised, and persons under the age of 16 may not play pinball after 11 p.m., and it is illegal for one to make a disturbing sound at a fair. A disturbing sound at a fair. Let's move over to Hawaii. Maybe we'll have some better luck in the nice, clean, clear, warm, tropical island of Hawaii. In Hawaii, you will be fined for riding in the back of a passenger car without a seatbelt. However, you can ride in the bed of a pickup truck with no safety equipment. You may only have one alcohol drink in front of you at a time. Billboards are outlawed. All residents may be fined as a result of not owning a boat. Coins are not allowed to be placed in one's cars. So that is Hawaii. Why don't we do one more, and we'll do Idaho. In Idaho, it is illegal for a man to give his sweetheart a box of candy weighing less than 50 pounds. You may not fish on a camel's back, and riding a merry-go-round on Sunday is considered a crime. And residents may not fish from a giraffe's back. So those are the dumb laws for Georgia, Hawaii, and Idaho. And we're going to move on to some real topics, some real interesting topics, and we're going to start off with the U.S. education system. Okay? This is ridiculous, the U.S. education system. When you take a look at these things, the U.S. students slide in a global ranking on math, reading, and science. So American 15-year-olds continue to turn in flat results in a test that measures students' proficiency in reading, math, and science worldwide, failing to crack the global top 20. The Program for International Student Assessment, or PISA, collects test results from 65 countries for its rankings. In mathematics, 29 nations and other jurisdictions outperform the United States by a statistically significant margin. This is one of the things that I can't stand. You keep people stupid, and this is what happens. It's ridiculous. The education ranking in America should be high. Maybe we should start going to school all year round. So, the top 10 ranks for education. One, we have South Korea. Then we have Japan. Number 3 is Singapore. Number 4 is Hong Kong. Number 5 is Finland. Number 6 is the United Kingdom. Number 7 is Canada. 8 is the Netherlands. And 9 is Ireland. and 10 is Poland. The U.S. ranks second in ignorance, but we'll get to that a little while later. There's some very, very silly things. The U.S. ranks 33rd in internet download speeds. The U.S. ranks 24th in literacy. The U.S. ranks 17th in educational performance, 11th in fourth grade math, 6th in fourth grade reading, and 16th in where to be born. So the U.S. ranks 12th in age of first sex education. So there's just some statistics there from Ranking America. Just to know a little bit more about what's going on in your own country. So the educational ranking, the global ranking, and we're going to go ahead and turn it over here to a video about what the real American education system is. So we have some great sources here, and we're going to go ahead and we're going to put that on here. This is the real deal, folks. This is exactly what's happening in America with the education system. So let's go ahead and we'll take a listen.
America, one of the richest countries on earth, the world's only remaining superpower. It's home to some of the world's biggest companies and best universities. Some say the cradle of innovation. But American leaders warn the nation risks losing it all if it fails to fix its education.
The future belongs to the nation that best educates its citizens. America's place as a global economic leader will be put at risk if we don't do a far better job of educating our sons and daughters.
Welcome to broken, failing, outdated.
Hi, I'm Soledad O'Brien.
Almost every day, the media sounds yet another dire warning about the inadequacy of the U.S. education system.
Evidence is unassailable that we are in the middle of a crisis in public education.
Disaster on top of disaster.
A failing public education system in this country.
And the debate has raged on for decades.
We cannot meet the complexities of modern life with outmoded school systems.
And as anxieties grew, so did the spending. In 1970, the U.S. spent about $4,000 per student per year. In the next four decades, spending more than doubled. But more money failed to produce better results, as reading and math test scores flatlined over the same period.
We are not seeing the results based on the amount of money that the U.S. spends on schools.
And while the latest federal report shows an improving picture, high school dropouts also continue to be a significant national problem. In 2010, more than 1 million students left school without graduating. That's almost 7,000 students every day. The U.S. president has called it a dropout crisis. And basketball star LeBron James even made this public service announcement.
My life is full of statistics. Thing is, I could have dropped out of school and become one myself, but I didn't.
And despite decades of reform attempts and billions of dollars of investment, U.S. students still ranked only 31st in math, 23rd in science, and 17th in reading, compared to other international students.
Antagonists.
China came first in all three categories.
1, 2.
This is E.L. Haynes, a charter school in Washington. It's one example of how America is trying to fix its public school education.
Everybody's going to go.
Charter schools receive public money and are part of the public school education system, but they run independently and have more autonomy in choosing their teaching methods.
The one thing I really like is the camaraderie with the other team members and the autonomy to kind of do my style of teaching with my kids.
Over 5,000 charter schools now operate across the country, enrolling more than 1.5 million students. They've been especially popular in cities like Washington, New York, and Los Angeles, providing an alternative to often low-performing neighborhood schools. In most cases, the demand is so high, schools hold a lottery, required by law to decide who gets to go.
All right, so this guy, I need you to whisk.
A process that for parents like Sarah Wilson essentially places a child's education in the hands of luck.
It's a game. And if you don't know how the game is played, you're going to stand there and get knocked around.
Is that enough? Wilson has lived in Washington for 10 years. She says she never thought finding a school for her oldest daughter would be so complicated.
It was about 2 months of just pure exhaustion. I think the capital of the free world, we should have pretty universal consistency of quality with education. but that's not the case.
Wilson says in Washington, the demand for good schools is so high, parents must enroll their children for lotteries at both traditional and charter schools, sometimes starting as soon as the child turns two.
First row, first column.
The Wilsons were so overwhelmed, they decided to hire an educational consultant. Evie Downey worked as an admissions director at a private school before she realized she could start her own business, helping Washington-based parents navigate the city's educational maze.
It's a catch-22. We're very, very, very fortunate that we have all these options. And yet, yes, in the U.S., we shouldn't have schools in which 85% of the kids are reading below grade level. We just shouldn't. It just shouldn't happen.
Downey says most of her clients want to find acceptable schools in Washington to avoid a long commute. But many do choose to leave, moving out into the suburbs for better schools. Marie Chowdhury is one of them. She and her husband just bought a house in a suburb outside of Washington. They found their location only after studying the rankings of dozens of local schools.
I won't take a chance. School is the most important thing for me right now. Of course, education is the most important thing right now.
Fari is not alone. Every year, many families move to suburbs where schools are generally better. And here is why. In the United States, education is the responsibility of individual states. The federal government provides on average just 9 to 10% of school funding. The rest comes from the state and local property taxes. So the wealthier the neighborhood, the higher the house prices, the more money is available for local schools.
We have not always properly funded our public schools, and that even in this country, inequities exist, and that certain school districts are better funded than other school districts.
The wealthier parents can also send their children to private schools, like this one in the Georgetown neighborhood of Washington.
So the way to get that effect is
it costs about $30,000 a year in tuition, though the school does give scholarships to about 20% of its student body. But that option is usually out of reach for many.
She doesn't know. And
so some parents are taking it upon themselves to improve their local public schools, like this group of Capitol Hill parents meeting before the city's hearing on the school's budget. Martin Wellis has three children. For the past 3 years, he spent all of his free time revamping their local public school.
Private schools in D.C. for three children is anywhere from $50,000 to $100,000 a year for three children, right? And that's not how I want to spend my income.
And yet, many parents have no choice but to stay in low-performing school areas. Cherie Jones is a single mother and volunteers for D.C. Promise Neighborhood Initiative. Cherie says for low-income families, even sending the child to a different part of town is not an option.
The D.C. public school system doesn't have like a public school. The school bus doesn't pick you up outside your house. You have to use public transportation, which can range anywhere from $38 to $50 for some families.
Some 16,000 schools in the U.S. serve high poverty communities, mostly in urban areas. Experts point out that poverty and parental neglect are some of the main reasons why students perform badly. But others disagree. Dr. Ian Roberts is a former Olympian and the principal of Academies at Anacostia, a public school in one of the most economically disadvantaged areas of Washington. Just 3 years ago, it was considered failing and persistently dangerous. Now, it's what's known as a turnaround school.
We try to have a new excuses mentality. Of course, individuals, right? A lot of our young people who are coming from very challenging backgrounds, whose economic status really prevents them from getting some of the same opportunities that others. But that does not necessarily mean that it should impact their ability to achieve at high levels.
The school is fighting to reduce dropout and suspension rates and raise test scores. Robert says his dream is to make Anacostia Academies one of the top-performing schools in the city. He believes his teachers will be key in achieving that goal. But in the pursuit of rebuilding American schools, teachers, and especially their unions, have been accused of standing in the way of reform.
Okay. Did you get
Former D.C. Public School Chancellor Michelle Rhee caused a firestorm during her 3 years in office, closing underperforming schools, introducing a new system to evaluate teachers, and tying their pay to student test results. But teachers like Maya Garcia says the overbearing oversight has proven counterproductive.
The stress to increase student gains, it puts a lot of pressure on teachers. It puts a lot of pressure on teachers' families. Teachers are burnt out. They're feeling like they're ineffective and they're receiving feedback that's not meaningful.
Because it's a rectangle.
Teachers say what they need is smaller class sizes and government's help in ensuring the children come to school prepared.
This country needs to decide what its priorities are. Are its priorities the children? I think the first thing the government should do is to ensure that every child in this country is well fed, well nourished, and well attended to.
Bart says change is underway. Private, charter, and public schools are starting to share their best teaching practices. But it may still be years, if not decades, before U.S. classrooms become the envy of the world once again. Rosa Kazan, CCTV, Washington.
Honestly, I don't see the American education system being the envy of the world anytime soon. You might be asking yourself, well, how does this come into play when it comes to information security? Well, it all starts in our schools. If you don't learn how to learn in school, you're sure not going to learn how to learn in college, and you're just going to be another automaton paying debt. So we'll be right back after this message. It's the Shadow Radio.
Hi. We're your local high-speed internet and cable provider. Are you looking for a fast, reliable internet connection? A large selection of your favorite HDTV channels? With 24/7 access to the best customer support technicians, all at a fair price? Fuck you. You'll take what we give you. You'll have the option of choosing from several of our completely unwarranted ripoffs, including internet speeds up to 200 times slower than Korea, at twice the price, TV packages with over 500 channels, 90% of which you can't view, and we guarantee a plethora of hidden fees. Then, our barely trained technicians will come to install your services somewhere between the hours of 8 a.m. and 10 p.m., knock once while you're in the shower, and promptly leave. And once we do finally get your service up and running, it'll be down and limping within 3 hours. Indefinitely. Why, you ask? Simple. We are part of what is called an oligopoly. It's like a monopoly, only legal. See, in closed-door meetings with four or five of the other major providers, we've secretly agreed not to have differing prices, allowing us to completely eliminate any competition and collectively raise our prices to optimum cockbag levels. Because we here at your local high-speed internet and cable provider don't believe in customer satisfaction. We believe in money. Pools of money. Looking for a better deal? You can all gobble down our balls. You're paying for it. Your local high-speed internet and cable provider. You won't like it, and there's no other option.
We're back here. This is Shadow Radio. Yeah, definitely want to take the first honest cable company there, so that's absolute truth. I kind of enjoyed that. The next topic we're going to cover, nobody wants to talk about. Well, in fact, a lot of people want to talk about, but don't want to talk about. Of course, that's religion. So we're going to do what everybody says not to do. Religion and politics, those things you shouldn't talk about. Well, I'll talk about anything that I want. It's my show. If you don't like what I have to say about religion, I really don't care. You know, as long as you're not hurting anyone, I don't care what you do or how you do it. But there's some things that you have to know or some things that you should know. There's a video that I want to play. I'm sorry, not a video, but there is a discussion that I want to talk about involving Richard Dawkins. And Richard Dawkins is one of the foremost atheists in the world. He's a professor, pretty smart guy. But I just wanted to show you this next interview here, and just take a listen closely.
Well, after we first brought this topic out in the open, most of the emails that we received were from people who thought that we should have included an atheist in our discussion. So now we're going to turn to one of the world's most prominent atheists. Richard Dawkins is an Oxford University professor whose bestseller sparked worldwide controversy. The God Delusion argues that belief in God is not only irrational, but it can be deadly. Paula spoke with him just a couple of days ago.
Why are you an atheist?
Why don't you believe in Thor? Why don't you believe in Zeus? Nobody believes in most of the things that you could believe in. You're an atheist with respect to the flying spaghetti monster. I'm an atheist with respect to the Judeo-Christian God because there is not a shred of evidence in favor of the Judeo-Christian God or indeed any other God.
It strikes me that the atheist message is particularly threatening to some Christians because they believe in some way you're trying to compromise their ability to have this stuff out there on the public stage. Is there any public role, as far as you're concerned, for religion?
I think people should be free to believe whatever they like, to write whatever they like, to say whatever they like within reason. But the problem is that religious people, I think especially in America and also in the Islamic world, are in the habit of getting it all their own way and are remarkably intolerant of atheists.
But why do you think they're so remarkably intolerant of atheists?
Well, I think there's a sort of historic misunderstanding of what atheism is. For some reason, people have been brought up to believe that atheists have two horns and a tail. I mean, there are figures that show that atheists are the most mistrusted group in America, which is pretty astonishing considering, as I say, the innocuousness of what they actually are. They're just people who hold a different belief system.
Certainly you have encountered people, though, who are intimidated by your message and that in some way it puts perhaps their own faith in doubt?
Well, why would anybody be intimidated by mere words? I mean, neither I nor any other atheist that I know ever threatens violence. We never threaten to fly planes into skyscrapers. We never threaten suicide bombs. We're very gentle people. All we do is use words to talk about things like the cosmos, the origin of the universe, evolution, the origin of life. What's there to be frightened of in just an opinion?
Final question. How would you characterize the overarching public reaction to atheism?
Misunderstanding and really missing an awful lot of what's valuable, because if you're an atheist, you know, you believe this is the only life you're going to get. It's a precious life. It's a beautiful life. It's something that we should live to the full, to the end of our days. Whereas if you're religious and you believe that there's another life somehow, that means you don't live this life to the full because you think you're going to get another one. That's an awfully negative way to live a life. Being an atheist frees you up to live this life properly, happily, and fully.
Richard Dawkins, we really appreciate your time tonight. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Welcome back. We're talking about discrimination against atheists and how the fear of becoming outcasts keeps many atheists underground. Let's turn to our Out in the Open panel again. Atheist Ellen Johnson is here with us, the Reverend Jesse Lee Peterson, and radio talk show host Rachel Maddow. So let me turn to you first of all, Ellen. Do atheists bring this on themselves by going to the Supreme Court with campaigns like trying to take the words "under God" out of the pledge, trying to take the words "in God we trust" off of the currency? You're 1 to 3% of the population. Why are you so noisy?
By trying to uphold the Constitution of the United States, I think that's being a good citizen. I think that we should be applauded for it. However, most atheists are in the closet, unfortunately. We haven't seen that. This is just the tip of the iceberg. And when atheists start coming out more and more, then we'll see more problems. But what the problem really is, and what it stems from, is that religion is losing out in America, and the religious know it. There's empty pew syndrome. There's a lot of competition among religions. And there's just the modern life. People are not going to church like they should. So the churches have to go to where the people are. They're going, the military is under siege. The prisons are under siege. The workplaces are under siege. And the public schools are under siege. And the religious are getting very angry and they're fighting back. And when they see an atheist who tries to uphold the Constitution and challenge them when they break the law, then there are all kinds of problems. And mind you, they also go after religious people. Mm-hmm. In Pontotoc, Mississippi, when a Christian woman said that organized prayers in that school, the public school systems there, were wrong and she challenged it, they went after her with a vengeance.
Right.
Bishop John Shelby Spong received 15 death threats because of his liberal views.
So
it's not
Reverend,
just atheists.
Reverend Pearson, you're losing out? Is that
no,
why you're discriminating against these people?
Atheists are hypocrites.
What they're trying to do too is impose their godless lifestyle upon Americans, and especially upon Christians. This great country was built on the idea of God, family, and Constitution, and they want to change that. Now, if they want to be an atheist, it's okay to do that, but just go and do it, and don't try to change America. Remove God out of the lives of everybody. Christians are just fighting back, and real fast, we saw the same thing with the radical homosexual movement. They decided to come out of the closet, and what they did was they imposed their lifestyle upon Americans. Now they have redefined
the
family.
She was with you for a second, and let me read an email that we got here. This is obviously from an atheist who talks about this idea of who has rights to do what. He writes, quote, "You ask atheists not to impose on your rights to have prayer in school and to have God in the Pledge of Allegiance. Atheists ask you not to impose on their rights to have prayer taken out of school and to have God taken out of the Pledge of Allegiance. On what basis do you assume that your rights should be taken as precedence over an atheist?" Well, obviously, Christians are in the overwhelming majority when it comes to Christians versus atheists, but does the Constitution, Rachel, not only give you freedom of religion, but freedom from religion?
The Constitution gives you freedom from religion. It creates a government that is explicitly non-religious.
So it should be equal rights, yes?
You can say that America is a Christian nation in the sense that America is a Christian majority nation. You're right. But we have a secular government. And the way we protect religion in this country and the way we have become such a religious country is by protecting religion, by keeping it utterly separate from the public sphere and from government. And so there's there is not equality among religions under the American government. There is freedom from religion. Freedom from religion is what we have.
Let me ask this question. There is a common perception among Christians, or at least a common case that Christians sometimes make, that atheists, because they do not believe in God, are morally compromised. Are you morally compromised?
No, that's just bigotry. They know who atheists are. I have to respectfully disagree with Mr. Dawkins, Professor Dawkins. The theists know very well who we are, and they're not misinterpreting us or misunderstanding us. That's just bigotry. And in order to make religious people feel better, they have
then
to say
lies.
Where
do you get your morals from? Christians get their morals from God, from the Bible, from God. Where do you get yours from?
It's not about where we get our ethics from.
Where do you get them from? It's a question.
Right? No.
That is a question.
Idea that we don't have ethics is not borne out. No one sees that. We're not the ones that are, abusing children. Professionally religious people.
Are you saying Christians are abusing children?
I've got to call a timeout here, folks.
An Oklahoma state legislator is coming under criticism for a speech in which she says homosexuals are destroying the United States and are more dangerous than terrorists. Republican State Representative Sally Kern was addressing a small audience when she was secretly recorded.
Studies show that no society that has totally embraced homosexuality has lasted more than a few decades. So it's the death knell of this country. I honestly think it's the biggest threat, even that our nation has, even more so than terrorism or Islam, which I think is a big threat. If you've got cancer or something in your little toe, do you say, I'm just going to forget about it because the rest of it's fine? It spreads. Okay, and this stuff is deadly and it's spreading and it will destroy our young people, it will destroy this nation.
The Oklahoma Republican State Representative Sally Kern has confirmed she made the comments and has refused to apologize.
Unbelievable. So that's her comments. And this is Oklahoma State Legislation, Republican State Representative Sally Kern. Now, just to recap some of her comments. No society that embraces homosexuality lasts for more than a few decades. Well, the Roman Empire lasted about 500 years, and there were a lot of homosexuals there. Written records of history of China can be found as early as 1200 BC under the Shang Dynasty. So, are you talking out of your ass, or are you another Sarah Palin? So, Sally Kern, how in the world did you ever get in to government thinking like that? These are the kind of people that are tearing this country apart, saying things like this. You have to accept people for who they are. Just because you don't agree with something somebody else does, that doesn't give you the right to chastise them, to criticize them, to put them down. Goodness. Some of her other quotes, it's a death knell, the biggest threat, more than terrorism, more than Islam. Homosexuals are more of a threat than Islam, and more of a threat than terrorism. somebody just shoot me. This is ridiculous. And you'll notice that a lot of people, you know, I don't want to get into Republican or Democratic or any kind of bipartisan. You know what I mean? I call it as I see it. And this is the kind of stuff that really gets me going, because this is nonsense. Everything about what she said was nonsense, you know. And as you close the doors, you'll find one thing is true with people. Especially in America, is that when you close the door and you think no one's listening, there's that line that people cross that when they think no one's watching. So they will cross that line. So it's spreading, and it will destroy our children and this nation. What a load of bullshit. Sally Kern, I don't even know what to say. I am at a loss. Why don't we turn to somebody who's actually educated, you know, like a physicist, like a scientist, somebody who has half a brain and an IQ above 80. Let's turn over. We're gonna listen to Michio Kaku, one of my favorite physicists here, talk about can science deal with God. So this is how this should come about. This is how a discussion should happen. Let's take a listen.
Your parents were Buddhists. You were brought up through Christian schools, and you obviously became a physicist. How do you reflect on this fascination we all seem to find with the science-theology nexus?
Well, I've always had two parts of my brain that were in constant warfare with each other. In Buddhism, we believe in this timeless nirvana, where there was no beginning, no end. And yet, when I went to Sunday school, I read Genesis, and I read about the fact that there was a beginning to the universe. And then there was also a doomsday, an end to it all, which seemed to violate the Buddhist precepts of nirvana. I'm a physicist today, and today we have a multiverse idea where we can meld these two ideas together, the fact that there is a nirvana, which is the nirvana of the multiverse, higher dimensions where bubble universes pop into existence, and there was a Big Bang. In fact, many Big Bangs, many Genesis taking place all the time as bubbles pop into existence and pop out of existence. Ever since ancient peoples looked up in the heavens and saw the stars, they wondered, where do I fit in this larger cosmic scheme of things? What does it all mean?
Well, how do we progress forward? Is this just metaphor, or is there some real serious ideas that we can learn?
I think we have to take some of the parables of the past seriously, because ancient peoples did come up with rational explanations, at least in their mind, to why there are things. Now, science, of course, says that we have something called reductionism. We split atoms apart, we look smaller and smaller and tinier and tinier objects, and that's the reason why we have the internet today and radios and television, microwaves and flat screens, TVs, because of reductionism.
Sure.
However, reductionism ultimately comes to a halt. We busted atoms apart and found lots of particles that had no rhyme or reason. Well, now we have a more holistic point of view, string theory, which says that we have to look at the entire universe. A universe of strings, a universe which explains why we have so many particles as musical notes on a vibrating string. I think one of the most common denominators of most religions is the idea of harmony, synthesis, harmony. And when you look at science, science also obeys some of the fundamental philosophical directions that are found in ancient societies. The search for harmony, the search for unification. And that's why Einstein said that he believed in the God of Spinoza, the God of harmony, that the universe didn't have to be as harmonious as it is, but he did not necessarily believe in the personal God, the God of prayer. He thought there was a lawgiver, that is, the laws
and
of...
And there you have it. Michio Kaku, arguably one of the most intelligent people on this planet, discussing can science deal with religion. It's interesting enough that when you look up some statistics on the internet and you find some good sources, sources that are, you know, reliable, you'll notice that a lot of people who are religious, the IQ always goes down. That's something that people don't want to accept. But there are a lot of scientific studies out there, and this will put a lot of people up in arms. You know, my personal belief is you can believe whatever you want. You're free to believe whatever you want. But when you start to push it onto other people, when you start to push it onto children who haven't had a chance to choose for themselves, you destroy their ability and their free will to choose what they want. You know, I see a lot of people, you know, in rural areas around the United States discussing, well, it's our one true God, or it's this, or it's our one true God, or you know what I mean? If you were born in a different country, such as Pakistan, or you were born, you surely wouldn't be Christian, okay? It's all about your surroundings and how you grew up. So I don't ever want to hear somebody tell me, well, Christian God's the only true God, or the Buddhist God, whatever. It's all nonsense. You know, when you start to look at the history of humanity and you start to see, you know, back during ancient Egyptian times, where they worshipped the sun and Ra and you know, some of the weird name gods that they have there, such as Anubis, you find out that it's just a progressive way to maintain control. You always have a leader at the top, you know, looking down upon everybody, and it's usually a man. So, you know, women who believe in religion, I can't believe, or I hate to even speculate, because women who believe in religion, it's a male-controlled and dominated society. It's been that way for a long time. And if you're a woman, I would never believe in any religion. You know what I mean? Dominated by a male figure. I mean, all you have to do is just rationalize it for a second. So anyway, that was Michio Kaku. We're going to take a break here, and we'll be right back after these messages.
I hate these doors. They're impossible to open.
Wait, I have kid knives. The knives for kids.
Who needs a toy gun? We have kid knives.
Kids knives. Finally, a knife made just for kids.
Yeah.
Kill it, kill it, kill it. Spider hair.
We're sorry we can't take your call. Please, cleave a message out of the beat. Kids knives.
Tired of your parents not letting you play with their knives? Now there's kids knives. Same great knives, but for kids.
I'm DJ Stab.
I got this one, Dad.
Whoa, where'd you get that cool knife?
My allowance. Thanks, Mom and Dad.
Yeah, stab it. Go, go, go.
Collect all the kids knives accessories. X-ray proof box.
Take it off, please.
A stabbing dummy. Double kids knives.
It's two knives.
And don't forget the bayonet.
I'm a patriot.
What'd you say about your sins, Abraham Lincoln?
You can stab me, but you can't stab this country's freedom.
Ah!
Kids knives. Don't get caught without one.
What are we going to do?
I got this.
We're back.
Kids knives. Knives for kids.
This is Shadow Radio, and make sure that you get your kid a kid's knife for Christmas there. We're back here, and the next topic that we're going to go to, we're going to actually combine them into two, which are prisons and crime. Two things, great topics. If anyone's ever seen a prison, visited somebody in prison, seen the conditions, we all know that they're atrocious. They're horrible. You get pretty much nothing. The food's horrible, and you're basically turned into a number. Good moneymaker, I guess. You know, we have some great topics coming from some very reputable people discussing what goes on in prisons, how crime, filling up prisons, things like that. We have a great talk, a speech, and an interview here by a man by the name of Mark Kleiman, who's going to discuss fighting crime. And we're also going to talk about mass incarceration and the conspiracy to keep us behind bars by none other than one of my favorite movies, Predator star Jesse Ventura. So it's time to bring Painless out the bag, ladies and gentlemen. Like I said in the post, this is going to be a hard-hitting show. We're talking about those topics that nobody really wants to talk about. They want to ignore them. They want to play on their iPhones. They want to go to work. And what we really should be doing is worrying about other people. And I think that's the connection, why we love our devices so much. It's not a fact of that we love our devices because we're geeks or whatnot. I mean, some of us are. But we love the ability to connect with people. We love that ability to talk to somebody across the world across or overseas at any given time, learn about their new culture. And a lot of times that's taken advantage of, you know, our want and or need to communicate. So let's take a look at something here. We're going to look at Mark Kleiman here talking about crime, why punishment isn't working, why it's not working as a deterrent. You know, we have crimes, we have a high crime rate, we still have the death penalty, things like that, which is what we'll get to here in a little while. But let's take a look at Mark Kleiman here and see what he has to say about crime and punishment.
If the criminal justice system were a parent, we would call it abusive and neglectful. It punishes too much and not often enough. My name is Mark Kleiman. I'm professor of public policy in the UCLA School of Public Affairs. I teach courses in methods of policy analysis and drug abuse and crime, and edit the Journal of Drug Policy Analysis. I wrote When Brute Force Fails because I'm both excited and angry. Angry about having much too much crime and an intolerable number of people behind bars. And excited because out in the field, people are doing things that could change that. There are more people behind bars in the United States than in any other country in the world. We have more prisoners than China does. Not per capita. We have more prisoners than China does. With 5% of the world's population, we have 25% of the world's prisoners. Basically, we've got a criminal justice system that doesn't know what every competent parent knows. That you change people's behavior by giving them clear rules, and by enforcing those rules consistently and quickly and fairly. The worst thing about our criminal justice system is its randomized draconianism. We're very severe in the way we punish people, but we do so very irregularly, very erratically. The basic reform is to substitute swiftness and certainty for severity. The average probation violation leads to no punishment at all, but an occasional probation violation will lead to 6 months in prison. That's the best possible way to fill up your prisons and not change anybody's behavior. Typical probation department does drug testing and tells people that they're not supposed to use. And if a test comes back positive, the probation officer says, don't do that again. And the next time it happens, the probation officer says, don't do that again. And the third time, the probation officer says, you know, if you keep doing this, you're going to get in trouble. And the fourth time he says, this is your last warning. And about the eighth or ninth or twelfth time, they're seeing the judge, and the probationer might be off to prison for 6 months. Lunacy. He had no way of knowing that the last warning was really the last warning. If you've got a large number of violations and can't punish all of them, there are two approaches. You can punish more or less at random, in which case everybody learns that mostly he's going to get away with it. Or you can pick some subset of offenders, of offenses, of locations, of times. Pick some part of the universe and say, okay, here's the rule within that part of the universe. So concentrated enforcement means deciding what you're not going to tolerate and who you're not going to tolerate doing it. Directly communicating that threat to the people whose behavior you want to change and then carrying it out. If offenders were perfectly rational, crime control would be easy. Ratchet up the severity of the punishment to the point where even a small probability of being caught means it's not worth it. That's what we've been trying for the last 30 years, and it basically hasn't worked. Everybody is more sensitive to immediate consequences than to future consequences. Everybody is more sensitive to certain than to uncertain consequences. Offenders are probably more like that than the rest of us. They're more reckless, they're more impulsive. Therefore, it's even more important to move the consequences close in time to the offense and to have the link be highly probable. There's a trade-off between severity on the one hand and swiftness and certainty on the other. And we've known for a long time that swiftness and certainty are more important than severity. What's not adequately understood is that severity is the enemy of swiftness and certainty. Severe punishment can't be swift because there's a lot of due process involved, and it can't be certain because you're chewing up a lot of resources, right? So that 25-year mandatory sentence under the California Three Strikes Laws, that's 25 people who can't be locked up for a year. And it's a little strange that the people who are loudest about opposing wasteful government spending haven't noticed that long prison terms are wasteful government spending. I agree that vengeance is an important part of justice. The tone deafness of official criminology and the legal academy to the need for vengeance seems to me has contributed to the problem. I mean, if you acknowledge the need for vengeance, then you can say, but it ought to be proportional. The resistance to using DNA testing to find out whether somebody's guilty comes from the prosecutors, the cops, and the victims. Not all of them, but often enough. And the psychological mechanism is clear enough. Right? From the victim's point of view, what matters is that somebody was punished for that crime to validate the victim. But it ought to matter a little bit whether it was the right person. Of course, higher incarceration to some extent must work because the people who are in prison aren't committing crimes on the outside. Now, if we counted the crime rate inside prison, the crime drop would not have been as dramatic. I was a strong advocate of building more prisons back when we had fewer than 500,000 prison cells. The first additional 500,000 was well worth doing. The next 1.5 million, not so much. We may do with a fifth as many prisoners as we have now. Everybody else in the world does that. We got to figure out how to do that. As Pat Nolan says, right now we're imprisoning a lot of people we're mad at. We only ought to imprison people we're afraid of. There are three groups of people who ought to be in prison, and only three. There are people who do such appalling stuff, we want to make an example of them. So Bernie Madoff. People who are violent criminals and whose rate of crime is high enough, so it's just worth the $40,000 a year to not have them in our hair. And then there are people who won't behave on the outside. Put an ankle bracelet on them, takes the ankle bracelet off. Okay, he's picked himself for prison cell. Everybody else we can adequately punish and control in the community. The key thing about the American system is that we have police chiefs who are appointed by elected mayors and prosecutors, district attorneys, who are themselves elected officials. They are very sensitive to what the voters want. And what the voters have wanted ever since the crime boom in the 1960s is revenge on the criminals. In some ways, I think the voters were right to say, hey, crime's a big problem, we should do something about it. Unfortunately, they were badly misled by their politicians into thinking that random severity was a good solution. We should be striving for having as little crime as possible with as little actual punishment as possible. We should do as much as we can to make threats do the work of actual punishments. This is Schelling's principle. The perfect threat is the one that never has to be carried out.
So that was Mark Kleiman talking about criminology, how the system doesn't work, how it's been a failure. And we see this every day. Nobody's doing anything about it, and we all know why. We all know because it's too much of a moneymaker. I have come to the conclusion that I can trace anything, any problem in this world, any serious issue or problem in this world, back to money. Any single issue that you can think of. And I challenge you, who are listening here, to send me an email and try to figure out a problem, preferably in the United States, to stump me on for me to tell you that it doesn't have to do with money, because they all do. You know, I've come to that conclusion. I can trace anything back. So that's a horrible thing. Let's take a break here, and we'll be right back after these messages. You're listening to Shadow Radio.
Toilets. Toilets are made so that people can sit down and take a shit. Anyone can sit on a toilet, and if the toilet is large enough, two people can shit together and tell jokes, or make up stories, or just listen. Toilets are for people, and that is why toilets are like Facebook, magazines, Febreze, toilet paper. These are things that people use when they shit together, so they can open up and connect about ideas and music and other things people share. Handle toilets are just like Facebook. Button toilets, just like Facebook. Self-flush toilets, just like Facebook. No flush toilets, Facebook. We all want to connect. Sometimes we just don't know how. That's why we have toilets and Facebook.
So we're back here at Shadow Radio and Facebook. Good for you there. I want to turn the show over to one of my favorite people, Jesse Ventura here. Runs a conspiracy show. A lot of people want to yell conspiracy theory when a lot of things come out, when a lot of people say things. They want to say, get your tinfoil hat. They want to make all these random comments until it becomes true or until it can be proven. You know, and when it's proven, oh, you were a smart guy. I can't believe you said that. Oh, but before you were calling conspiracy theorists and everything. You know what the biggest secret is? A lot of people, conspiracy theories are real. You know, they're no longer theories. You know, the conspiracy theorists are the greatest researchers on the planet, I think. And anyone who's going to say, go get your tinfoil hat or you're a conspiracy theorist, is either working for the government or doesn't know how to read. Who knows? But I think that you should pay attention to what Jesse Ventura has to say here. You know, conspiracy to keep us behind bars. So let's take a listen here.
There's money to be made off keeping us in jail, and business is booming. Are you part of it? We're number one. We're number one. We're number one in putting our own citizens in prison. That's right. The U.S. leads the planet in incarceration. So let's look at the conspiracy to keep us behind bars. Let's go to my vigilant producer, Alex Logan, in the command center. You know, Alex, it is football season, and you do hear that chant, we're number one, you know, whether it be high school, college, or the pros, whatever it could be. But I'll tell you, what could be more warming to our heart, huh? As we of the United States of America, land of the free, home of the brave, are now number one at having the most people in jail. Should I be happy over this? Should I feel safe that all these people are in jail and so life is wonderful? Or should I be questioning how a country that claims to be the bastion of freedom can have the most prisoners in the world now? Not just the quote-unquote Cold War free world, correct? But the whole world.
The whole world. And when you look at the numbers, I think it's going to make you question, Governor, because according to the International Center for Prison Studies, the United States has the highest prison population with 2,228,424 people in the slammer. China comes in second with 1,701,344 people, and Russia is in third with 674,500 people. But when we compare that with the total population, the U.S. comes in third place with 318 million. So that means about 0.7% of our total population is behind bars. According to Think Progress, in states including Louisiana, Mississippi, Oklahoma, Texas, Alabama, Arkansas, Arizona, and Georgia, at least 1% of male residents were in prison on December 31st, 2013. And another 12 million individuals cycle through the county jail system in a given year for periods of less than a year and are therefore not factored into a snapshot of December 31st. There are also other mechanisms of incarceration not factored into this figure, including immigration detention, civil commitment, and Indian county facilities. Makes you proud to be an American, huh, Governor?
I'll tell you, this is shameful in my opinion. We have over 500,000 more people in jail today than China does. I would like, too, to know how many of these prisoners, do you have a percentage of them, Alex, are drug-related?
I do. Nearly half, 48% of inmates in federal prison were serving time for drug offenses in 2011.
Nearly half.
And that's from the U.S. Department of Justice.
So nearly half of the prisoners in there are in there for committing a crime against themselves, which again comes back to my philosophy in what is supposed to be a free country. How can one commit a crime against yourself? It's high time that drugs not be treated criminally and be treated medically. If we switch to that, then there won't be dealers anymore. So you'll have no reason to put them in jail either. Continue on, Alex.
Well, let's get back to this high rate of incarceration and how the increasing number of Americans with a criminal record has also affected employment rates. According to a recent study in the Washington Post, as a result of policies intended to curb violent crime and drug use, more and more people have been arrested, convicted of a felony, or sent to prison in recent decades, especially among black men and men without little education. In 1980, roughly 3% of U.S. adults had a felony conviction. In 2000, the number was 6.5%, and today it's 8.4%. The article states people with any kind of criminal history face a number of obstacles when they look for work. A prison sentence is a lost opportunity to learn useful skills while on the job, but even someone with a felony conviction who has never been to prison may face legal barriers to working in all kinds of occupations, from hairdressing to policing.
Time out. Did you say hairdressing?
Hairdressing, exactly. There are laws against...
You can't be a convicted felon and do someone's hair?
According to the Washington Post, you cannot.
What the hell has being a convicted felon got to do with being a hairdresser? What, you're that close to another human being that human being's automatically in danger? What if you got convicted of a white-collar crime?
They fall under the jurisdiction of the Department of Public Health. Many licensing and permit statutes authorize an agency to suspend or revoke a license or permit based on a conviction of a felony. And one of those includes hairdressing because it's under the Department of Public Health.
I hope all women out there are breathing a sigh of relief today that when you're underneath that hair dryer and it's blowing and it's loud, you can still read and fall asleep feeling good knowing that who's ever running the hair dryer is not a convicted felon.
And aren't we just hurting ourselves by not giving these people a fair chance?
Exactly. Job. Doesn't everybody deserve a second chance? Why would you deny a convicted felon the opportunity to be a beautician?
The Center for Economic and Policy Research estimated in their 2010 report titled Ex-Offenders in the Labor Market that had that 1% of American adults kept out of a job by felony convictions been able to work, they would have added around $60 billion to the economy.
Yeah, now wouldn't that be wonderful? $60 billion more dollars to our economy, that much more paid into Social Security so that the elderly can collect their Social Security checks. You know why it don't happen, Alex? It's too logical. I've been in government. I'm a logical person. That's why I don't fit. That's why the square peg can't fit into the round hole of government, because logic and government are oxymorons. These people, many of them deserve second chances, and in many cases, if it's a drug crime, we ought to apologize to them for what we did to them. They committed a crime against themselves. Whoa, who am I to point the finger? Keep our conversation going at the websites below, and as always, stay vigilant and now stay out of jail.
So that was ex-governor Jesse Ventura. Now, one thing I want to make everybody aware of, as a governor, you can get pretty in-depth and get into a lot of things and find out a lot of information about our own government. You'll notice that Jesse Ventura no longer lives in the United States. I wonder why that is. We have another piece regarding mass incarceration in the United States, and I wanted to get that out there so you guys could listen to it real quick. So let's take a listen here.
Good morning, John. It's Friday. A few weeks ago, a company called Visually emailed me and was like, "Hey, Hank, if you could do a high-quality animated video on any issue in the world, what would you choose?" Now, that was a hard choice. But I went with incarceration in America because it is messed up. Now, crime is also messed up. Bad things happen to good people, and that's terrible, and something should be done about it. Well, we send people to prison to be punished and to prevent them from doing bad things again and to deter others from breaking the law. Punishment, corrections, and deterrence. Now, we have this habit of thinking of prisoners as something very external to society. After all, there are literal walls between them and society, walls capped with razor wire and watched over by people with guns. But millions of prisoners are released each year. Today's prisoners are tomorrow's neighbors, so corrections should probably be the most important piece of the incarceration pie. Unfortunately, it is not. We are, however, really good at punishment. America has about 4% of the world's people and about 25% of the world's incarcerated people. We have the highest incarceration rate in the world. Over the last 30 years, that number has skyrocketed, increasing over 400%. 41% of American juveniles and young adults have been arrested by the time they turn 23. Children as young as 13 years old have been sentenced to die in prison. And our prisons violate international standards. Solitary confinement increases instability and violence, and inmates and is considered by international international law to be torture. But in America, it's not regulated by anyone except the prison officials. No judge, no jury. Arguably the most devastating form of punishment we enact in this country, and yet there is no appeals process. And you think it's hard to get a job in America? Well, we make it intentionally more difficult to get a job once you have a conviction on your record, not to mention just to live your life. Convicts are ineligible for welfare, student loans, public housing, food stamps, and are often socially disconnected from community and family support structures. So in addition to having high recidivism rates, they have very high rates of homelessness and suicide. Somewhere along the way, we started to think that being tough on crime meant being tough on criminals, but that's not the same thing. Punishment is only one piece of a much larger crime reduction pie. And it's an expensive one, with some institutions paying more than $100,000 per year per prisoner. Long prison sentences have helped to decrease crime, but no more than 25% of the decrease we've seen can be attributed to incarceration, and it costs far beyond just dollars. The cost is to people, to our country, to communities, to families, and to ourselves. The policy seems to be if you've committed a felony, we just give up on you. These wars on crime, wars on drugs, they are wars on people. The smart political move is to appear tough on crime because crime is scary, so we increased minimum sentences, we arrested more people, we sent more of them to prison. That's how we looked tough on crime, but the results are in. It's bad policy. It's cruel, it's short-sighted, and to continue this policy of mass incarceration would be foolish. We're living inside of a massive $75 billion per year failed experiment. 2010 was the first year in nearly 40 years that the number of incarcerated individuals in America did not increase. Policymakers are beginning to realize the magnitude of this failure, but there is a long way to go.
Those are the facts, ladies and gentlemen. Those are the facts. This is the country in which we live. Everybody simply wants to ignore these things. Ignore them, or just not pay attention, but they're there and they're not going away. This information is 100% correct, and you can search on the internet, find sources for yourself, and I hope that you do that. Don't take my word for it. Go figure it out for yourself. Okay? We know we have a problem. Everybody just ignores it. You know? So we heard from Jesse Ventura, and we heard from scientists, we've heard from lots of different people about the prison system and how it's messed up and how it's not working. So what do we do? What's the solution? You know, when it comes down to spending money to help prisons, well, no, we'd rather spend it on something else, you know, because that's the last thing that would be getting funding. But apparently, prisons are making a lot of money because they're becoming privatized. So, where do you go and what do you do? You know, the next topic that we have here, of course, racism. Racism in the United States. Yes, it exists. It exists, ladies and gents, and everybody knows that. And everybody knows that. Especially in the South. I hate racism. I'm racist against racism. So, I mean, I have a great social experiment here from the show What Would You Do? That's a great show that does social experiments to illustrate just how severe the racism problem is, and it exists. And it not only exists against Asians or Black Americans, or racism is running rampant against all races, everywhere, at all times. You know, what are you going to do about that? You can't change away in a day the way people think, you know? But there are a lot of us out here who are a little bit more enlightened to understand that, you know, race isn't a problem for most of us. You know, mostly the people who have problems with races are the older white men, you know, the older, above 60 white men. And that's true. I don't care. You know, slash, but whatever. And if you're above 60 and you don't have a problem, that's fine. You know, I'm not saying everybody. I'm just making a generalized statement from my observations. So why don't we take a look at this social experiment here and see what happens, and you make your own judgments. But it's pretty obvious in this social experiment how racism's perceived. So let's take a listen here.
You see this and you wonder, did he lose his keys or is he blatantly stealing that bike? In broad daylight, he hammers and then saws on the chain. When that doesn't work, he pulls out an industrial-sized bolt cutter. And when he's asked, he
fesses up.
Have you lost the lock?
No, not exactly.
But he's not a real thief. Justin Kelly is an actor, and our hidden cameras are rolling.
What happened? Nothing, I can't get through the lock. I mean, I know it's weird, but you wouldn't happen to know whose bike this is, would you?
No.
All right, good, thank you.
While the scene troubles Tim Lucas enough to turn around for a second look, he's on a family outing. His wife looks alarmed too, but they both move on.
Colleen, my wife, she's like, he's totally stealing that bike. She was like, call the cops.
It turns out Lucas is a pastor, but our thief's confession is safe with him.
It was odd that somebody had all that equipment.
But you didn't do anything.
No.
That's true.
That's the bottom line.
Lots of people stop and stare. A few even question the actor.
Doesn't have to ask. Is that your bike?
I guess technically no.
Okay.
Bye. Bye.
When no one tries to stop our thief, he ratchets it up a notch with an electric saw, even putting on a pair of goggles. That finally catches the attention of Arlene Menard and her husband, George.
You're not stealing, right?
No, why? It's not your bike, is it?
I just want to know if it's your bike.
No, it's not my bike, but it's not yours. What do you care?
It may be next time. Well, it's not yours. I'll just let somebody know.
As Arlene sets off to find help, we decide to clue the couple in on our experiment.
I think most people don't want to get involved in a situation like this, and so they just pass it by.
George is right. In over an hour, about 100 people pass by. Only George and Arlene try to stop him. Some tell us they plan to call the police later. Others say they're scared. Keep moving. This woman and her friends give our thief the benefit of the doubt. When we ask why, Bisa Washington tells us first impressions matter.
I remember thinking, young white men don't usually carry burglar tools.
So we all make assumptions, huh?
Yeah.
I'm thinking maybe he works for the park. And our thoughts were, if he'd been black or a person of color, the police would have been called in immediately.
We're going to do that experiment with an African-American kid. What do you think's going to happen?
Oh, I think people will be very distressed.
I think someone's going to whip out their cell phone and call the park police.
Yeah. Will they? We replace our white thief with this young man. Matlock. Remember, both actors dress in a similar way and are about the same age.
Is that your bike?
Nah.
Then what do you cut the chain for?
Right away. Somebody yelled.
Wow.
Within seconds, another person confronts our thief.
Is that your bike?
Technically, it's not, but it's going to be mine.
More people converge.
Is that the one?
You call the police. He's like stealing somebody's bike.
Are you taking that bike? That your bike?
No, it's not, sir.
Oh, why are you doing that?
Is this any of y'all bikes? Is this your bike?
It belongs to someone.
It belongs to someone.
To who?
Well, not to you.
And sure enough, one man whips out a cell phone to call 911.
Yeah, there's someone taking a bike here.
Our actor triggers more reaction. Some people are even snapping pictures for evidence.
I got you, bud. I got you.
Guys, steal the bike. These bikes over here.
Once everyone moves away, we reset our cameras. And within minutes, another outraged man is yelling.
Are you trying to steal that bike?
Excuse me, sir, but the bike's been here for days. Like, no one's going to take it.
Well, that's not your bike, then.
Yeah,
you can't just come in and take something from somebody.
Excuse me, sir.
I'll just take your tools away then. Is yours, sir?
Please, sir. Don't touch my stuff, sir. Please, sir. Do not touch my stuff.
You're touching somebody else's stuff.
Yeah, all right. But this has been here. Like, who's gonna take it?
Well, that doesn't make it your property.
Technically, it does.
No, it doesn't. Technically, it's not yours to take.
All right, sir.
When we bring out our cameras, David Robb wants us to go after the thief.
That kid in the red shirt.
He's hacking away at a bike that's not his.
Days, and he has a right to take it and steal it. And he's come here with tools, obviously.
You know, sir? My name is John Quinones, and this is part of a TV show called What Would You Do? You were pretty upset.
I was.
It's important that we speak up in these situations.
I think so. It just seemed like the right thing to do.
Everyone insists that justice is colorblind.
Did the race of the culprit have anything to do with it?
Not at all. He could have been any color. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't have mattered to me.
I think it was taking a bike that wasn't his, not what his color was.
Maybe, but take another look at how people passed right by the white actor.
I need the police department.
But not the black actor. Madlock sits nearby, stunned by what just happened.
These racial stereotypes are infused in all of us. I mean, it's part of our culture. So whether you're black or white, you associate crime with blacks and you associate whites with being good.
Jack DeVideo, psychology professor at Yale University.
Whether we believe it, whether we notice it, whether we acknowledge it, race is affecting what I see, what I think, what I do.
DeVideo says we all seize openings to reassure ourselves that we're not biased.
Lost your key?
Yeah, actually I did lose my key.
So when given an opening like this lost key explanation, people may respond kindly. Challenging the actor might come off as racist.
So I get the bag, you get the fuck.
Good luck to you.
Thank you, sir.
So that's that. Enough said. We all know. And I think it's really interesting who you find that are going to call the police or who you find. And just judge for yourself. Ridiculous. I really can't stand that kind of racism and that kind of behavior. But there's really nothing you can do about it. And these are the kind of people that are running our country. You know, these are the kind of people in the Tea Party. And these are the, you know, you got to let that stuff go. Well, sooner or later, it's going to destroy you and everything else. But then again, what are you going to do? This is Shadow Radio. We'll be right back after these messages.
Let's be completely honest. Our lawyer says we have to. No company really wants to be responsible. And we're no different. But GM didn't kill the American car like we killed public transportation. Because let's face it, we stopped being a truly American car decades ago. Gracias, mi amigos. We at GM have been screwing your tailpipe for 100 years. And now with your help and the inefficiency of the American government, we're gonna screw you again. So here's what the new GM's going to be. New, efficient ways to ignore the customer. A leaner, meaner workforce, or at least angrier. And new opportunities for government circumvention. Greener, faster, smarter. In effect, more Japanese. And we're more committed than ever to profits and to the oil companies. Because at GM, we're not surprised we're obsolete. We plan for it.
We're back here, Shadow Radio. The next topic we're going to cover today is stupidity, ignorance. You know, why do a lot of people dislike Americans? You know, I think it's because they dislike our leaders. You know, I've spoken quite a few times to people overseas in different countries who have a bad opinion of Americans. And this bothers me because it's not us. It's not us. It's our leaders. You can't chastise all Americans because of our leaders. Our leaders make the decisions that give everybody else a bad rap. So I really can't stand that. So, are Americans stupid? Well, for the most part, judging by our education system and what we've seen on the news with people giving out their passwords for information security purposes, most people in the United States can't even name all 50 states. Most people, according to Bill Maher, can't even name the three parts of government. You know, so we're going to play a couple things here with respect to that topic. I also want to cover the topic, is the U.S. good or evil? Why people hate the U.S.? Well, there's a good reason for that. You know, our leaders make decisions that hurt a lot of people. When you have a country that's ran by corporations, and when you introduce money into government and Congress by lobbying, it's just ripe for abuse. So you're never going to get away from that unless things change, and everybody knows that. But it's also the people who are controlling the country who don't want those things to change. So what do you do? It's almost deadlocked here. So, is America stupid? Let's hear from Bill Maher.
I want to get to this issue because I heard you just say something about they're stupid, and I heard you say the word idiot. You talk about what we were just talking about.
Republicans.
Yes. Okay.
But there was a. I didn't say stupid. Though.
Yeah, you did. I heard it. You said the word stupid, and I'm bringing this up because this guy Jonathan Gruber. He's an MIT professor who worked on the Obama health care
plan. Oh, you're moaning.
Okay, wait. Big controversy because they found a tape of him basically saying the American people are stupid because he was saying a lot of tapes. Because what he was saying was to get the bill passed, we had to do a lot of sleight of hand or else they never would have voted for it. If we called it a tax, even though it was a tax, you have to, like, basically slip a pill in the dog's food, I mean, in a piece of ham to get the dog to eat the pill.
Yeah.
I agree. And I've heard nobody else in America say that. Everybody on the left and the right, oh, how could he call Americans stupid? Show the clip of the one man in America who agrees with him. But I would never put anything past this stupid country.
Because people are dummies. They don't know what's going on.
I think a lot of them are just dumb. I'm the bad guy for saying people are dumb. They're not bright enough to really understand the issues.
People are already complaining that you're calling the United States a stupid country and giving you a chance to clarify.
I don't need to clarify. It is.
yes, you're
right. Jonathan Gruber, you have met your soulmates. How this is even controversial, I have no idea.
It was pretty fun. Literally, when you were playing that, I thought back to a debate I had with John Avlon on CNN, and I said voters were stuck on stupid. He said, Roland, we can't call the American people stupid. I said, yeah, we can call a lot of them stupid. When you look at the actual studies, how many Americans can name all 50 states in terms of civics, we can go down the whole line. We have some fundamental issues. We want to play nice when it's also just about being honest. We have too many people who have checked out of our process.
Only 42% can name the three branches of government. 35% can't name any branches of government. If you just want to stick with Obamacare, you ask people, do you like Obamacare? Hate Obamacare. Then you ask them, do you like what's in it? We love that.
No, or do you like the Affordable Care Act?
Right.
Absolutely. But Obamacare, hate it. It's
also,
the same thing.
45% say the economy is the most important issue. You know what the average American thinks the unemployment rate is? 32%. It's 5.8. Even in the Great Depression, it was 25%.
You ever ask what foreign aid is?
Foreign aid. They think that's right. Most money. They think the Americans what they think we spend the most money on. 33% spend say foreign aid. You couldn't find it in the budget with a jeweler's eye. 60% believe the Noah's Ark story is literally true. How everybody in the media can defend the American... How dare you say they're stupid.
There was a movie on that. It must be true.
What movie?
Noah's Ark.
Noah's Ark,
it's in the
right.
Movie.
Oh, I thought you meant Dumb and Dumber. I thought you meant that one.
I'm the only non-American here, but I'm going to defend Americans.
Are Canadians smarter?
Canadians are very smart, especially the people who live in my district. Those are the smartest Canadians. Toronto Centre, I love you.
Wow, that's a suck up right there. I got you.
Gotta do
yes,
it.
Way
you
to go. You're getting
but
reelected.
I'm defending Americans here.
Because, how do you pronounce about?
No,
about. So you're
about.
Wrong. You know
no,
everything.
But the fact that Americans have checked out of politics or that Americans find the health care reforms to be really confusing, I don't think you can blame regular American people for that. I think you have to blame the media and politicians for
that.
Can
you blame them for not knowing the three branches of government, for checking out on that one? Because that one happened a lot before health care came down the pike.
But we're talking about health care, and we're talking about the...
They're stupid.
Gruber was right.
He just said what people don't want to hear.
He said that we're going to take the money from the people who can afford insurance and are healthy and young and don't have expensive illnesses and give it to people who are sick and older. Everybody knew that.
And also,
where else was it going to come from?
We live
Some
in a democracy.
Place?
Louis Gohmert, Michelle Bachmann, these people didn't get there by a coup. Somebody elected these morons because they represent them.
Bill Maher, everyone. One of the most honest television personalities I can think of at this moment in time, in any moment in time, just telling it like it is. We'll be right back after these messages.
Here at Apple, we are obsessed with breaking new boundaries, and today we throw all of that out the window, and yet somehow still break boundaries. We have found a way to sell the exact same iPhone a year later, changing nothing but the name, and sell millions. And we call it the iPhone 5S. The S stands for same.
We think you're really gonna love it. Take a look. Isn't it revolutionary? To create the new iPhone, we started with a design that we really loved, and then stopped. The iPhone 5 has been hailed as the best phone of all time, because people said so.
What this tells us is that people don't really want change. Their love for Siri proves that ignorance is bliss. They still want to go on unforeseen adventures with Apple Maps. And they still prefer the phone to auto-hang up on phone calls with annoying friends. So it would be stupid to change what is already perfection.
The iPhone 5S is the best iPhone that we've ever created because of all the reasons.
We decided to spend more time on marketing because all that time added up is time. Added up. We laid off our entire engineering staff to show how dedicated we are to this new direction.
I think there is this profound and enduring beauty with how much we're able to get away with. And we push that as far as we can.
We have become incredibly innovative, without exception. We're breaking new ground every day on how to deceive our mindless, loyal customers.
We have decided to take our world-famous secrecy public by taking the same secrecy to the products while you have them.
We haven't even put the new name on the back of the iPhone 5S, so you too can be just as deceptive as we are.
The new iPhone 5S is definitely the best phone.
You won't even notice you're using the new iPhone 5S. You won't even remember upgrading to the new iPhone. In fact, you're already using the new iPhone 5S. We did an over-the-air update and automatically billed your iTunes account. You're welcome. But there's one more thing. We are also launching a completely new product. It's called the iPhone 5C. C stands for cheap. It's plastic, so now everyone can afford an iPhone, even the peasants. Actually, we did change one thing. Your existing cables will no longer work. Introducing the magical new cable, the Lightning.
We're back here, and that's right. Apple's selling the same product for years on end, so I love the people who just stand in line and camp to get the new product from Apple, which happens to be the same product, which happens to be the new product. You get it. So we're on the topic, is America stupid? Well, in my opinion, yeah. I think I'll have to agree with Bill Maher. Here's another reason why America is stupid.
Did you hear what they just did in the South Dakota legislature? Did you hear about this today? The South Dakota House of Representatives has passed a resolution urging public schools in that great state to teach kids about climate change in a very specific way. I'm quoting here, "Now let it therefore be it resolved that the South Dakota legislature urges that instruction in the public schools relating to global warming include the following. One, that global warming is a scientific theory rather than a proven fact. Two, that there are a variety of climatological, meteorological, astrological, thermological, cosmological, and ecological dynamics that can affect world weather phenomena." I think they mean affect with an A, not an E, you guys, first of all. But also, can we just put that second part back up there? There are a variety of astrological dynamics that can affect weather. So maybe it keeps getting hotter every year now because we're having a hot horoscope. The South Dakota House of Representatives is urging public schools to teach that astrology might explain climate change. It's in the stars. Also, thermological? Anybody want to venture a guess as to what they mean by thermological? This resolution actually passed. They voted on it. They passed it. Which puts the South Dakota House of Representatives in the running for the single most humiliatingly idiotic thing in the news all week. There is competition, though, from Congressman Trent Franks of Arizona, who told video blogger Mike Stark of StarkReports.com that black people in America were better off under slavery than they are in America today. Because, you know, abortion is legal now and stuff.
In this country, we had slavery for God knows how long. And now we look back on it and we say, well, how blind were they? You know, what was the matter with them? You know, I can't believe. I mean, 4 million slaves, this is incredible. And we're right. We're right. We should look back on that with criticism. It is a crushing mark on America's soul. And yet today, half of all black children are aborted. Half of all black children are aborted. Far more black children, far more of the African-American community is being devastated by the policies of today than were being devastated by the policies of slavery.
Far more of the African-American community is being devastated by the policies of today than were being devastated by the policies of slavery. Congressman Trent Franks of Arizona solemnly intoning how much better off we were under slavery. Because, you know, the abortion and stuff.
That's right, folks. You heard it first here on Shadow Radio. Black people were better when it comes to slavery as opposed to today's laws. Unbelievable. And these are people who run our government. They run our government. So, there's really nothing you can say. There's really no level of anger or no level of redemption. Nothing. There's nothing that you can say after hearing something like that that would make any other country believe that we got our ducks in a row. So, that's that. Next thing I want to cover today is the death penalty. Now, the death penalty is a pretty high topic when it comes to American politics and whatnot. So, just to give you a couple statistics here, 3,000 death row inmates currently on the U.S. The U.S. Supreme Court suspended the death penalty in 1972. You can look up the case Furman versus Georgia. It was suspended and then reinstated in 1976, Gregg versus Georgia. So, from 1800 to 2013, 14,295 people were executed in the United States. That's people, yes. Persons, human beings. Not numbers, but people. The death penalty is legal in 32 states, and lethal injection is the primary method used. However, hanging, electrocution, gassing, and a firing squad is still illegal. So, here's another interesting fact. In 2005, the Supreme Court rules executions of juveniles unconstitutional. That's Roper versus Simmons. Then, between 1976 and 2005, 22 juveniles were executed in the United States. Unbelievable. Japan is the only industrial democracy, is the only other industrial democracy that has the death penalty. And let's compare and contrast. From Japan, Japan executed 8 people in 2013. The U.S., 38. Okay, so we have the highest prison population. Okay, we execute the most people. We have the worst one of the worst education systems. How far does it go? You know, it's amazing that we made it this long. Now, don't get me wrong. I love my country. I love the United States. I just, most of the time, can't stand the people who are running it into the ground. You know, there's an idea that was the United States a long time ago. I still believe in that, you know, but I wish more people believed in that. You know, when you introduced money is just the worst thing that you can introduce into a society that has to do with making laws, which are a portion of a society or a branch of a society that makes laws. Poverty's running rampant. There's too many things, you know. And we're also going to discuss some other points today. Legalizing marijuana. Well, I'm not much of a weed smoker, but you know what? It grows from the earth. Just freaking legalize it already. You know what I mean? This is probably the only thing that I can imagine and see that they wouldn't want to make money from. And the only reason it's not legal yet is because the pharmaceutical companies would stand to lose a lot more money. You know, if people are going to be self-medicating and growing their own drugs, you know, pharmaceutical companies aren't going to be too happy about that. Once again, we can trace that back to money, not what's good or best for the citizen. You know, you have somebody who has a terminal illness with cancer, and it's been medically proven that marijuana will help, you know, somebody who has a terminal disease such as cancer with their pain, and you're not going to legalize it, at least in some states. You know, some states are starting to legalize it, so I think I'm all for it, you know, legalize it, you know. But I definitely wouldn't want my doctor smoking a joint before he comes in and operates on me, so I mean, use within reason. And we've already seen, you know, what use within reason is. I don't know that I've never seen any DUI incidents with weed, you know, or marijuana. I've seen quite a few crashes with alcohol, which happens to be taxed and regulated by our own government. So we're still on the topic there of stupidity and ignorance. And I have a little special treat for everyone here. We have Sarah Palin, and this just takes the cake. So, Sarah Palin trying to talk at a university intelligibly. Let's take a listen to Sarah Palin showing her normal soccer mom ridiculous nonsense. Here goes.
This is an amazing campus. You students are so fortunate to get to be here. You guys are doing an awesome job. This amazing infrastructure addition and the amenities provided all of you. What a wonderful force for good in this part of the nation and really all over the world. Liberty, way to go. Mm-hmm.
Governor, you have, you're traveling like from one end of the country to the other. You're doing the book tour. Basically, you've been traveling since, 2008. You meet people everywhere.
It rubs the lotion on its skin. It does this whenever it's told.
People you're meeting, the country that we're living in. What has this experience been?
Because my book is about protecting the heart of Christmas, which is really about protecting the heart of America. Because the message of Christmas is a message of real hope, not the hopey, changey, dopey stuff you hear coming out of Washington, but real hope in our Lord and our foundation in this country being this Judeo-Christian faith that helped provide really all the foundation in our charters of liberty, in our Constitution, our Declaration of Independence.
Okay, you blathering idiot, I'm going to have to stop you right there. Sarah Palin, the United States government, is not in any sense founded on a Christian religion. President John Adams said this, the Treaty of Tripoli in 1797. Let's continue your idiocy.
It was a faith-filled people that understood how blessed our land was.
Allow me to interject again for those of you not listening. Doesn't she mean the American Indians or the Indians' land? Silly me, forgetting history again.
And the opportunities that we have for reward for work ethic, all the things that has made America so exceptional. Growing up in Alaska, I think you can't help but see God in the creation that is around you. And as a little girl at a summer Bible camp, I gave my life to the Lord, having looked around at my surroundings, realizing,
Yeah, look, everybody, it's a flower. It must be God.
Yeah, well, the lamestream media wants to rewrite history. They don't want you to know that our founders, and then as the years went on, those who fought slavery and wanted equal opportunity and rights for all.
Hold the phone. Let's rewind that shit.
They don't want you to know that our founders, and then as the years went on, those who fought slavery and wanted equal opportunity and...
Okay, soccer mom. By the way, our founders owned slaves. They even sold them and had sex with them. Where is your brain, you retarded moron?
Absolutely, they were godly men, and they understood.
No, they weren't godly men.
The blessings of liberty, and that's what they fought for. John Adams wrote that our Constitution was created wholly for a moral and religious people, and our Constitution would be irrelevant and impossible to follow. It would be no good, and it would be inadequate for any other people.
This sucks more than anything that has ever sucked before.
If you lose that foundation, John Adams was implicitly warning us, then we will not follow our Constitution. There will be no reason to follow our Constitution because it is a moral and religious people who understand that there is something greater than self. We are to live selflessly.
Says the multimillionaire on her national book tour.
And we are to be held accountable by our Creator. So that's what our Constitution is based on.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
That's right. So more kudos to Liberty University here. Thomas Jefferson and his thinking, I believe that much of it fundamentally came from this area. Having spent his summers here, having spent influential years here, 2 miles away from Liberty University. Mm-hmm. Man, there's something in the water perhaps around here. Again, you are fortunate to get to taste it.
Mm-hmm. What do you...
That's a good way to put it.
What do you think Thomas Jefferson would say to those who now, you know, think that America shouldn't have nativity scenes in public places?
He rubs the lotion on its skin or else it gets the hose again.
What do you think he'd say if he was on Fox News?
If he were on Fox News. And thank you for advertising on Fox News, by the way, Liberty University. Thank you. That's where you're going to get some good information, folks.
Uh-oh.
But Thomas Jefferson today, he would recognize those who would want to try to ignore that Jesus is the reason for the season. Those who would want to try to abort Christ from Christmas.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's time for an actual Thomas Jefferson quote. I quote you, Thomas Jefferson, "I do not find in Christianity one redeeming feature. It is founded on fables and mythology."
He would recognize, for the most part, these are angry atheists armed with an attorney.
Wait a
they
minute.
Are not
Isn't the White House full of lawyers?
Americans. They happen, they rightly so, have a voice, but we have a voice too, and we shouldn't be afraid to stand up and let it be heard. And what the voice needs to say, the message needs to be received by these angry atheists, is no more double standards here in America. Why is it that they get to claim some offense taken when they see a plastic Jewish family on somebody's lawn, a nativity scene? That's basically what it is, right? Oh, they take such offense, though. They say that it physically even can hurt them, and mentally it distresses them, so they sue, right? But heaven forbid we claim any kind of offense when we say, wait, you're stripping Jesus from the reason, as the reason for the season, but heaven forbid we claim any kind of offense. So that double standard, I think Thomas Jefferson would certainly recognize it, and he'd stand up and he wouldn't let anybody tell him to sit down and shut up.
Here's another quote by Thomas Jefferson. Sarah, sit down and shut up.
So is there a war on Christmas?
There definitely is a war on Christmas, and Fox News covers this quite often.
Here you're going to get like a 10,000 amens.
It rubs the lotion on its skin, or else it gets the hose again.
When Christmas comes around, as it is now, like, what are the memories that you think of? Like, what makes you, you know, feel good inside from your childhood?
Well, I wrote a lot about that in the book because I wanted to share some of those Alaskana moments growing up there where we never had to dream about a white Christmas. You know, that's what we live with practically 8 months out of the year. And we live out that old jingle, over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house, we know, but we have a more efficient...
The fuck did you just say, weirdo?
We live out that old jingle, over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house, we know. Grandmother's house, we know.
Grandmother's house, we know.
It's to grandmother's house we go, you obtuse piece of flotsam.
But in the book, getting to share recipes, moose chili, some of the halibut dip and the salmon that we catch ourselves. The moose, you got to shoot it yourself too if you really want to appreciate the meat. Sharing a bit of my family's heart so that you can see that we too, we're real. We're as normal as any other family. You can eat organically, which we do. I love feeding my kids that healthy organic food, but I warn them, you got to go shoot it first, and then then we'll prepare it. Things like that.
You know, one of the things we do every year is we shoot mistletoe out of the trees with a shotgun. I just thought it was really cool to find out that it was evangelical pastors who led the charge against slavery and eventually got it outlawed. And now the same group is working to end abortion, and it's just... You know, it's the same history, just repeats itself in different ways. And
The message that's going out is that people like us, we're in the minority, we're going out, we're from another time to believe the Bible's true or to, you know, have the type of faith that we have.
What's the fucking lotion in the basket?
Absolutely, I'm hopeful because we're standing on time-tested truths. Other civilizations have fallen when they become selfish.
Buy my book.
Corrupt leaders, perhaps, and because they don't have a moral bearing, because they don't believe in a God. They don't serve
Thor,
God.
Zeus,
the one
Apollo?
True God. Those civilizations, that they crumble. We're not going to let that happen in America.
I just got some student questions.
All right.
Okay, so here's one from Micah. Okay. What is your favorite Christmas song, religious or secular?
Don't know, don't care. How's that?
It's not easy to get to Lynchburg, Virginia, period. You know, some of you know. But, you know, coming from Alaska is a really long way. And for someone as busy as you are, we know it's not a small thing that you made the time to come and spend some time with us to finish out this semester. And so I think, you know, as a community, before we close this convocation in prayer, let's give one more round of applause for Governor Palin.
Thank you so much.
Ooh, man. That was rough. That was pretty rough. I'm sweating here listening to that kind of nonsense. There's only so much bullshit that you can take. But, ladies and gentlemen, one of my favorite actors, Matt Damon. Now, keep in mind, this was recorded a while ago during the presidency or the presidential race with John McCain and, of course, soccer mom Palin there. So here's one of my favorite actors, Matt Damon, on the topic. Individual who's actually well-read.
I think there's a really good chance that Sarah Palin could be president. And I think that's a really scary thing, because I don't know anything about her. I don't think in 8 weeks I'm going to know anything about her. I know that she was a mayor of a really, really small town, and she's governor of Alaska for less than 2 years. I just don't understand. I think the pick was made for political purposes, but in terms of governance, it's a disaster. You do the actuary tables, you know, there's a 1 out of 3 chance, if not more, that McCain doesn't survive his first term, and it'll be President Palin. And it really, you know, we were talking about it earlier, it's like a really bad Disney movie. You know, the hockey mom, you know, oh, I'm just a hockey mom from Alaska, and she's the president, and it's like she's facing down Vladimir Putin, and, you know, using the, you know, the folksy stuff she learned at the hockey, you know, rink. You know, it's absurd. It's totally absurd, and I don't understand why more people aren't talking about how absurd it is. It's a really terrifying possibility. The fact that we've gotten this far, and we're that close to this being a reality, is crazy. I need to know if she really thinks dinosaurs were here 4,000 years ago. That's an important, I want to know that. I really do. Because she's going to have the nuclear codes. You know, I want to know if she thinks dinosaurs were here 4,000 years ago. Or if she banned books or tried to ban books. I mean, we can't have that.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, is it any surprise that people call Americans stupid? When you hear things like this, and you hear a person like this get up in front of a group of people, a very large group of people, and say things like that, is it any surprise that the rest of the world thinks that we're all idiots? Unbelievable. So what do we do? You know, what are we going to do about this kind of nonsense? I don't really think there's anything that we can do. Let's move on to the next topic. While we're here, and we're going to look at poverty in the U.S., but before we do that, let's take a listen about 9/11. If you follow the evidence for 9/11, there's so many truthers out there, there's so many this and that, that are posted labels, and look, just follow the evidence. If you follow the evidence, it's obvious what happened. You know, we may not know the exact logistics of 9/11, but we know it was perpetrated by at least those in our government, or at least some people in some branch of our own government. Now, the ridiculousness is when people hear that, they're always complacent. They don't want to admit that their own government could have done something like this. And you know, we've seen time and time again that it's an absolute truth that they are capable of doing such things. So here, let's take a listen to some 9/11 bullshit war on terror nonsense and go from there.
The more you begin to investigate what we think we understand, where we came from, what we think we're doing, the more you begin to see we've been lied to. We've been lied to by every institution. What makes you think for 1 minute that the religious institution is the only one that's never been touched? The religious institutions of this world are at the bottom of the dirt. The religious institutions in this world are put there by the same people who gave you your government, your corrupt education, who set up your international banking cartels. Because our masters don't give a damn about you or your family. All they care about is what they have always cared about, and that's controlling the whole damn world. We have been misled away from the true and divine presence in the universe that men have called God. I don't know what God is, but I know what He isn't. And unless and until you are prepared to look at the whole truth, and wherever it may go, whoever it may lead to, if you want to look the other way or if you want to play favorites, then somewhere along the line you're going to find out you're messing with divine justice. The more you educate yourself, the more you understand where things come from, the more obvious things become, and you begin to see lies everywhere. You have to know the truth and seek the truth, and the truth will set you free.
It's time to wake up. The people in power go out of their way to make sure that you are perpetually misled and manipulated. The majority's perception of reality, especially in the political arena, is not their own. It is shrewdly imposed upon them without them even knowing it.
Armed with knives, armed with chemical, biological, nuclear weapons. Fanatics, terrorists, September 11th. September 11th, killers, September 11th. Terrorists, terrorists, Al-Qaeda, terrorists, nuclear weapons, terrorists. 9/11, terror, terror, terrorists, evil.
September 11th, September 11th, the terrorists, war and danger. September 11th, terrorism, global terrorism, terrorism, terrorists, 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 the terror, terrorists, terrorists, terrorism. September 11th, global terrorism, terrorists, terror, terrorism. September 11th, world terrorism. Terrorism, terrorism, terrorism. September 11th, global terrorism.
September the 11th, terror, 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 terror. Weapons of mass destruction. September the 11th, September the 11th, terrorists. The evil terrorists. Terrorists, terrorists, no.
Terrorism. The words are hypnotically repeated. Terrorism, terrorist, terrorist threat, and of course, believed to be linked to Al-Qaeda. But it's the so-called war on terrorism that's in our faces practically 24/7 as the inescapable focus of our existence.
One day, our grandchildren will look back on this time and ask, how was the war on terror won?
The entire U.S. ruling class, ruling elite, comes to see terrorism as the preferred means, indeed the only means, to provide social cohesion, to provide an enemy image for the society, to keep it together. According to neocon theory from Carl Schmitt, you have to have an enemy image in order to have a society. A very dangerous thing, because now it means that the entire social order, the political parties, intellectual life, politics in general, all based on a monstrous myth, monstrous myth.
Look, the CIA has done in this country, what they've done to us is unbelievable. Look at the terrorist acts that have occurred. The CIA behind most, if not all of them. We had the Marine Barracks. We had our embassy in Kenya. We had Pan Am 103. We had the USS Cole We had Oklahoma City. We had the World Trade Center in 1993.
The guy that helped the terrorists blow up the World Trade Center the first time, they built the bomb. They got the driver's license.
The informant, the informant, a fellow named Salam, a 43-year-old former Egyptian army officer, he was given the assignment to put the bomb together. And he went to his supervisor, his FBI supervisor, and said, we're going to put a dummy bomb in here, right? And the FBI supervisor said, no, we're going to put a real bomb.
The FBI actually carried out the attack on the World Trade Center in 1993. They actually hired Ahmad Salam and paid him $1 million and gave him real explosives, a detonator, and told him to build a bomb and to give it to the foolish people that he was controlling to allow them to attack the World Trade Center complex.
Unfortunately for them, there were only six people killed, not enough to pass the legislation. So what happened is 2 years later, April 19, 1995, down comes Oklahoma City, Murrah Building, 168 people killed. 1 year later, the anti-terrorism legislation that takes away many of our constitutional rights and civil liberties is passed.
Because at 9:30 this morning, we were actually running an exercise for over a company of 1,000 people in London based on simultaneous bombs going off precisely at the railway stations that happened this morning. So I still have the hairs on the back of my neck standing upright.
To get this quite straight, you were running an exercise to see how you would cope with this, and it happened while you were running the exercise.
Precisely.
Supposed to believe is some kind of coincidence, there was also an anti-terrorist drill going on 7-7. And again, just like 9-11, they were talking about attacks on the same targets, the same kind of tube stations, and exactly the same time as the actual attack happened, providing some kind of cover for what must be operations orchestrated in some way by the state.
I am absolutely appalled at how much people in this country do not think. We are given to understand that an Arabic guy out there up in the mountains financed the most elaborate attack on this country.
Do you think some people in a cave, were able to have NORAD stand down? Do you think that people in a cave were able to have all of this happen?
And when I think about how many Americans were killed in New York City, and believing as I do that this thing was a setup job, this is a textbook operation that Nazis used, and they've used it over and over again. America has been suckered in one more time.
So, where are we now? September 11th was the jumpstart for what is now an accelerated agenda by the ruthless elite. It was a staged war pretext no different than the sinking of the Lusitania, the provoking of Pearl Harbor, and the Gulf of Tonkin Lie. In fact, if 9/11 wasn't a planned war pretext, it would be an exception to the rule. It has been used to launch two unprovoked illegal wars, one against Iraq and one against Afghanistan. However, 9/11 was a pretext for another war as well, the war against you. The Patriot Act, Homeland Security, the Military Tribunals Act, and other legislations are all completely and entirely designed to destroy your civil liberties and limit your ability to fight back against what is coming. Currently in the United States, unannounced to most brainwashed Americans, your home can be searched without a warrant, without you being home. You can in turn be arrested with no charges revealed to you, detained indefinitely with no access to a lawyer, and legally tortured. All under the suspicion that you might be a terrorist. If you need a painted picture of what is happening in this country, let's recognize how history repeats itself. In February 1933, Hitler staged a false flag attack, burning down his own German parliament building, the Reichstag, and blamed it on communist terrorists. Within the next few weeks, he passed the Enabling Act, which completely eradicated the German Constitution, destroying people's liberties. He then led a series of preemptive wars, all justified to the German people as necessary to maintaining homeland security.
Am Schicksal des Kommunismus und der sich mit ihm verbrüdenden anderen Organisationen endet dies nichts.
Our enemy is a radical network of terrorists and every government that supports them.
I don't have to tell you things are bad. Everybody knows things are bad. The dollar buys a nickel's worth. Banks are going bust. Shopkeepers keep a gun under the counter. Punks are running wild in the street. There's nobody anywhere who seems to know what to do, and there's no end to it. We know the air is unfit to breathe, and our food is unfit to eat. We sit watching our TVs while some local newscaster tells us that today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be. We know things are bad, worse than bad. They're crazy. It's like everything everywhere is going crazy, so we don't go out anymore. We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, at least leave us alone in our living rooms. Let me have my toaster and my TV and my steel-belted radios, and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad.
I couldn't have said it better myself. We only have a few more topics to cover, but it just gets you irritated, mad. And you don't really know what to do. You know, the only way that we're ever going to do anything or make any changes is if we all get together and stop worrying about the differences and start thinking about what we have in common instead of what we have in differences. You know, the ridiculousness. And I'm at the point where I think that maybe it's even gone too far. Maybe all this stuff is unstoppable. We're on a train now, and there's no way off. So I would appreciate some ideas and some feedback. Final thing that we're going to talk about today is poverty in the U.S., and then we're going to do your community questions. In fact, I also want to put something out for abortion, too. I want to address that issue because a lot of people have some ideas about what kind of women get abortions or this or that. Well, let's clear that up right now. Let's have a listen to some actual information, real information, about abortion.
Who are the women who obtain abortions in the United States? You might be surprised. Almost one out of every three American women will have an abortion by age 45. They come from all walks of life. They are women you know. Most women having abortions are in their 20s. Many people mistakenly believe that teens are the group most likely to have an abortion. Teens actually account for fewer than 2 in 10 of all abortions, and most of them are older teens, those aged 18 and 19. 6 in 10 women having abortions already have a child, and many have 2 or more. They know what it means to be a mother, and they often cite the need to care for their children as a primary reason for deciding not to have another right now. 3 out of 4 women who have abortions describe themselves as religiously affiliated. Catholic women have abortions at about the same rate as women overall. Over the past decade, abortion has become increasingly concentrated among poor women. In 2008, more than 4 in 10 abortion patients had incomes below the federal poverty line. That's a huge increase from a decade ago. White women account for 1 in 3 abortions, more than any other group. However, women of color are disproportionately likely to have an abortion. The reason is that Black and Hispanic women have much higher rates of unintended pregnancy. These trends reflect widespread inequities in other areas, not enough access to contraception and to quality, affordable health care. And not enough educational opportunities and good jobs. These broad social and economic inequities must be addressed. But at a minimum, contraception should be easy to get and use for all. And comprehensive sex education should be available to all adolescents. But while prevention is key, there will always be women who need abortions. That's why abortion is basic healthcare for women. It should be covered by private insurance plans, as well as under public insurance programs such as Medicaid. Covering abortion under Medicaid is critical to help the poorest, most vulnerable women pay for their procedure. Any woman who needs an abortion should be able to have one safely and with dignity.
We're back. And yes, that information is true about abortion. You know, we didn't cover one thing that I did want to cover, and that was the botched executions and the U.S. That raises ethical concerns about the death penalty that we just discussed earlier in the show. So I want to play that real quick for everyone.
The death penalty debate in the United States has been reopened, this following the botched execution of an Oklahoma inmate. In fact, it takes an average of 6 minutes for a prisoner to die after they receive a lethal injection. With Clayton Lockett, however, it took seven times as long. He died in obvious agony 43 minutes after he was administered the drugs. Marina Portnaya has this story.
America is among the top five nations that lead the world in executions. But a recent lethal injection gone bad.
A typical execution should take between about 6 and 12 minutes.
Took 43 minutes, a vein burst, blinds were closed because something was going so wrong.
Is casting a spotlight on the inhumane methods behind capital punishment in the U.S.
The American public and the world is getting a close-up and personal look at the death penalty as it really operates. And what we're seeing is ugly.
On Tuesday, Oklahoma inmate Clayton Lockett died a slow and painful death after his lethal injection was administered. Witnesses say he was withering around for 43 minutes, telling doctors something's wrong before eventually suffering a massive heart attack.
Lockett began rising from the gurney, his head and his chest moving up forcefully. He tried to speak, it seemed like, a few times as well. The first two were inaudible, but the third time you could clearly hear him say the word man. He grimaced his teeth in his face a few times and moved around quite a bit on the gurney. His body shuddered a few times as well.
According to reports, the three drugs used to kill Lockett are not primarily intended as execution drugs and come with a host of warnings about suppressing the respiratory system and causing heart trouble.
In recent years, drug makers, mostly in Europe, have stopped selling their medications to U.S. prisons because they don't want their products being used to kill individuals. As a result, states have scrambled to find new suppliers and chemical recipes for executions. In many cases, officials refuse to disclose which drugs are being used and where they're coming from.
When the states are refusing to provide this kind of information, the tragic results that we saw in Oklahoma are what we're going to get.
In January, an Ohio inmate took 25 minutes to die by injection, gasping repeatedly as he laid on the stretcher. In Oklahoma, another prisoner complained of feeling his whole body burning after being lethally injected. The injections, by the way, are being administered by prison officials, not medical professionals.
Medical community, doctors in particular, are prohibited by their ethical oaths from participating in executions in this way. And one of the issues that has come up over and over again is whether the people who are actually administering the drugs and engaging the executions have the training and experience to do this in a way that is consistent with our Constitution.
Oklahoma has granted a two-week halt to all executions, but in many other states, critics say experiments on death row inmates will carry on. Marina Portnaya, RT, New York.
Currently, capital punishment is legal in 32 states in America. The most common method of injection is lethal injection, but electrocution and the gas chamber are still allowed in some places. Right now, there are over 3,000 people on death row in the states. And according to Amnesty International, a disproportionate number of them are from ethnic minorities or impoverished backgrounds.
So there you have it, ladies and gents. You're listening to Shadow Radio. Just telling the truth. Straight up. No bullshit, no nonsense, you know, no inflated values, just absolute fact. You know, if you take a look at all the topics that we covered in the show, you'll notice that a lot of them tie into each other in one way, shape, or form. Now, I did that intentionally. So, if you take a look at, you know, terrorism, 9/11, the death penalty, ignorance, all this stuff ties in to the perception of America as a whole. If you take a look at a lot of these topics, you'll notice that as you dig down and drill down, you find the bad seeds for what's causing this nation to fail. You know, I just wanted to say something too. George W. Bush, you are a murderer. I think that you should be tried for war crimes. No, this doesn't have anything to do with information security. I think that you got away with it. I think that you got away with everything, and I think that you need to pay the price for what you've done. You know, that's George W. Bush. You know? And by the way, Bush's approval rating when he left office was 22%. You know? So Bill Clinton got impeached because he did one bad thing. We all know what that is. And, you know, Bush killed millions and still allowed to walk around. Unbelievable. Has a lot to do, I guess, with his father being head of the CIA at one time. You never know. Well, enough of that. Let's go head over and move to the final portion of the show and take some of them questions here for Shadow Radio, show number 8. We'll start at the top and we'll go down. Adderley Gonzalez, his question is, why do people hate the new BlackBerry devices? I really don't know, Adderley. Personally, I've never used a BlackBerry in my life. I don't know why people hate BlackBerry. I'm not a mind reader. I guess it's just people have gotten used to either the iPhone or the iOS or Android operating system. That would be my best guess, is that people are just used to those new operating systems or those new mobile operating systems. Leon Kalad, if Tor is now unsafe, what other alternatives would I suggest? Leon Kalad says, I really like using Tor and hope that the developers can fix the hijacked nodes. Still hoping. Well, you have to understand, you're never going to have something like Tor and not have any agency or spies try to break it. It's just not going to happen. You can also try, you know, multi-layered encryption. That's the best thing that I can recommend for you, is multi-layered encryption, or develop your own ways of hiding your own data. You know, if somebody doesn't know your sequence of hiding data, then the chances are very slim that they're going to be able to crack it. So, frankly, I'm just tired of hearing about Tor. So, Matt Williams, next, if you could talk about any of them, was your favorite moment in a pen test, the best way you got around to security or business, something that was truly surprised you during the test. And he also says he thinks it would be nice to have a regular segment talking about pen testing experiences. I think that would be great, except that we need people to start calling into the show and doing those things. But to answer your question, there was this one company, very large company, okay, very, very large company, and it's very silly. You know, when you start doing pen testing, you always start to look for the most difficult answer or most complex answer. But for some reason, this day is a very large company, $1 million company. You go in and start doing my pen test, and of course, you know, the main server farm, he had a server farm, 20 server cluster, of course, had the default password set on, you know, the Windows server systems. When I say default password, I mean password. So you're going in there, and the question was, why is it so easy that everyone's able to break into our system? So apparently their IT guy didn't know how to change the password on a Windows server system. That's a true. So, that's what it is. Ryan O'Donnell, vendor firewall or personal built? Well, I don't trust vendor firewalls, for one, because they have the chips in them that can be programmed by, you know, unknown forces somewhere out there. So, you know, I'd rather just build my own computer and build a BSD router. That's probably the best thing that I do, you know. When's Pirate Bay going to live again, Lloyd Holt? I don't know, Lloyd. Hopefully soon. I liked Pirate Bay. I liked the torrents. I liked to download a lot of torrents. So, what do I think of Open Bazaar, Lloyd Holt? I don't think that I would use something like that, especially transferring with Bitcoin, things like that. I mean, when you have a decentralized system like Open Bazaar for trading and using Bitcoin. I think it has to have some backers to grow a little bit. As long as it remains open source, I think you'd be okay. The disciple says this is my favorite part of the community. Would never thought of this format could work for IT, but it does. Appreciate it, Dave. Thanks, the disciple. I really appreciate your comments there, and you also have something. How did Shadow get into IT and InfoSec? Well, when I was about 5 years old, I got my first computer. It was a 286DX monochrome screen. Started writing things in DOS shell. So that interested me right then, and I started to figure out how to do things with that computer and started to figure out how to do lots of neat design tricks, you know, with basic programming. So that's how I learned it. And, you know, we used to trade games when we were younger for those old machines. So that's how I really got into it. You know. Dear Shadow, my girlfriend says she's leaving me unless I spend less time on my computer. Girlfriend or InfoSec? Well, you have to understand that people have passions, you know, in the world. A lot of people have passions. So you have to look at it this way. You know, if somebody loves to cook, or if somebody loves to sew, or loves to do something, you want to take that away from them, you know. I mean, you have to spend time with your girlfriend. You also spend time, but you have to manage your time. You know, you have to use better time management. Of course, I wouldn't say pick anything over a human being. I'd rather pick a human being. If it come down to it, I would never pick the computer InfoSec or anything over another human being, you know, a wife or a girlfriend or anything like that, because, you know, computers come and go. When you find the right girl or you have a good girlfriend, you know, those are hard to come by these days. Okay, next question is, what is GeoClue? RK Hunter flagged it. GeoClue, I'm not real sure what that is. Let's take a look and see what I can find in my database to see about GeoClue. GeoClue is a dbus service that provides location information. The primary goal of a GeoClue project is to make more creating location aware. It might flag it. Its secondary goal is to ensure that no application can access location information without explicit permission from the user. It's free software. If you're not using it, the AIM projects utilize all sources of geolocation, so Wi-Fi based, GPS, 3G, and GeoIP. If you don't need it and it's not in your system, I'd get rid of it. You know, geolocation. It's, you know, sounds pretty common. What's, you know, for location services? So, should I add any form of math to my self-study for an InfoSec career? It's always good to know math, because when you get down to it and you want to calculate bits and... Yeah, I would say math is good. You know, study some trig and calculus. I love to do statistical analysis and things like that, so you can study things like probabilities and statistics, which is really good, because when you get into... You know, some fun stuff, like I enjoy random number generation programs and things like that. You need a little bit of math in order to accomplish your goals. Considering an online university degree in computer and IT, stages 2 and 3 paths are software, dev, networking, computer science, or solutions dev, which path would be the best suited for InfoSec? Well, the disciple, considering software dev, software dev and networking, you kind of need them both. So you need networking and you need software development, at least I think so, if you're going to be a real pen tester, because you're going to have to learn how the code works. So, you know, be a programmer first, be a pen tester second. Your favorite Python module when building your own tools. My favorite Python module. I don't think that I have a favorite Python module. I build my own stuff, but I don't think I have a favorite module. I mean, I like, if you wanted to say libraries or something like that, of course, sockets are probably my favorite thing to play with. I like playing with raw sockets and whatnot. And final question from the disciple here is, do you think your knowledge deters people from visiting your website? I don't know. I hope not. Do I think my knowledge deters people from visiting my website? Maybe. I think people look at things on face value way too much. You know, I think whenever people see a picture, like my logo, they already get a preconceived notion of who and what I am or what I do. So it's really hard, and that goes back to being uneducated, you know. It's not saying that anyone here is uneducated, so I'm really not talking about the people in this community. So Leon Collat asks, one say, we'll be getting a pen testing course in Shadow University. When I have time to do it, yes. I'm trying to get everything together on the network, so I'm working on it. And I hear the music coming in here soon, so we're going to have to knock off in a 2.5-hour show today. I think that's a great leap forward of what we can accomplish when we put our heads together. So don't forget to check out the comment section on information security community there. We're going to put that up so you can comment on the show and give questions. And if you want something in the show notes, please let me know. Radio.shadowsgovernment.com. And anything else that you want to know, and that's the music. So 2 hours and 30 minutes exactly, ladies and gents.